Here's how we got to 1-1 here in game two. Second power play of the game for the Edmonton Oilers. Watch Marty Turco reach for the poke check, and right at the same time, Marty Reisner was there to knock it home. Then on the 5-on-3, one of the great wrist shots from the blue line of the National Hockey League, Sergei Zubov scored to make it 1-1. That's where we stand. Dave Strader, Ray Ferraro, glad you're with us here as we move along in our coverage of the Stanley Cup playoffs, ESPN, ESPN2, and ABC. Matvichuk, top of the circle, takes it in deep, tried to dump it to the front of the net. Now it's recovered by Stu Barnes. He sends it across. And now Holtry is there. Now the Stars with three players in the lineup here for game two that were not in the lineup for game one. Felix Boucher is in the lineup. Lyle Odelein is out on defense. And now Holtry replacing Steve Ott from game one. And Claude Lemieux is out of the lineup here in game two with David Oliver going in. And another Edmonton penalty, Ray, set up by the hard work of the Dallas Stars in the offensive zone.
Dave, in game one, the Edmonton Oilers showed tremendous poise and patience. They didn't take very many penalties. That's not been the case here. Ferguson and Muller are battling for the puck here. Muller's controlling it in the corner. Ferguson's doing a great job right here until he punches him in the back of the head and takes the penalty. Muller was one of the grumpy old men 3 years ago, so I'm not really sure what you would call him now, but he still battles away hard. Ferguson takes a penalty. Dallas has done a great job forechecking the puck below the goal line in the first 13 minutes of this hockey game.
It's an old saying that rivalries are created at playoff time. This is the sixth time in the last 7 years that Edmonton and Dallas have met in the first round. The memorable series back in 97 when Dallas was the heavy favorite. Todd Marchand scored in overtime in game seven against Ed Belfour at Reunion Arena. The last four series have all been won by Dallas, but 20 of the 28 games over those previous five series decided by a single goal. Nine of the games have gone into overtime. That's how tight it's been when these teams have gotten together. Good work here by the shorthanded Oilers. It is cleared all the way down the ice. Marty Turco plays it ahead. Yuri Lehtinen deflects it deep into the Edmonton zone. Theo's back to get it. Nifty little play there to Dvorak, who quickly had it slapped off of his stick.
Three or four times, Dave, the Oilers have had chances to get this puck out of the zone on the penalty kill. They haven't done it. If you do that, generally, it comes back to bite you.
Power play number five for the Dallas Stars. 1-1 is our score. Zubov taking a look toward the net. Doesn't see a clear path. Hands it for Sidor between the circles. Scott Jonas shot deflected by Salo just wide. Salo has been sharp. He has had to be. It comes to Sidor, top of the circle. Tip score! Redirected in front. I believe it was Scott Young. It'll be a power play goal, and it is 2-1. Dallas.
We talked about not getting the puck out here. Darryl Sidor, a terrific play to Scott Young. This is a pass all the way. Zubov to Sidor. Look, his head's up the whole way. He shoots it to Young's stick. Jason Smith has him. He has position on Scott Young, but does not get his stick off the ice. Young's able to tip it past Tommy Salo. No chance for Salo. But the Oilers had an opportunity to get this puck out of the zone. They did not do it. And as I mentioned earlier, so often that comes back to bite you. Two power play goals in the first 15 minutes of the game for the Dallas Stars.
Dallas goal is first in the playoffs.
Young's first of these playoffs, his 40th career playoff goal.
Scott Young!
Here's DeMaio now as the Stars continue to work in the Edmonton zone, and now we have a whistle to stop play. 10-2, the shots on goal favoring Dallas. This one gets by on the deflection by Young.
And now the toughest leg of the strongman competition, Norm, the Bud Light Industrial Bridge Pull.
Jim, that's 1,000 pounds of pure hernia that they'll try to drag across.
Sorry to interrupt, Norm, but it looks like a fan from the stands has stolen the Bud Light. Oh, a huge hit from out of nowhere. And this guy's got the foot speed to take this thing all the way. Oh, man.
Come in, bro.
For the great taste that won't fill you up and never lets you down.
Okay, who's the hero?
Make it a Bud Light.
Hey, prima cock! Get off the ice! It's more like prima donna cock!
Hey, does anybody know the Russian word for loser?
It's prima cock!
Ladies and gentlemen, visiting from Western Russia, the parents of right winger Alex Prima cock.
Wanna get away? Now you can. Fly Southwest Airlines with fun fares as low as $49 each way.
You are now free to move about the country.
See you next week.
See you, Bill.
Good job, man.
Rusty, what's hurt?
Hey, we're trying to get home, man.
Introducing the Dodge SRT Series. Race inspired, street legal.
Sweet.
Scott Young, 40th career playoff goal. Sitting next to Ray Ferraro, a former Whaler. Scott Young, a former Whaler. Our producer, Jim Ciroli, still thinks the Whalers are in the National Hockey League. There's a little bit of a conspiracy going on here, but Scott Young proving his value again at this time of year. 40 career playoff goals.
Scott Young has a heavy shot. He gets a one-timer off on the power play as well as anyone. When Scott Young's an effective player, he's involved in the play. He's not a real physical guy, but he has to get his body in, bump along the boards, win loose battles for the puck. When he gets to the front of the net like that, he's going to have an effective night.
Boucher plays it along the boards. Here's Nico Kapanen, and he was bumped to the ice. No call coming. Lettinen hands it off. Looks for the return pass. It's deflected behind Salo. Just over 5 minutes remaining here in the first period. 2-1. Stars lead, trying to even the series before they go back to Edmonton for games 3 and 4. Eric Brewer around the boards. Ryan Smith is there. Just 2 shots on goal for Edmonton. They have scored, obviously, on one of them. They have had 2 power plays. Hemsky to Marchand. Pass to the front of the net, and Turco had to be sharp there to knock it away. And now Darian Hatcher sends it deep into the Edmonton zone.
No question, if there was any, that the Dallas Stars were going to come out and be physical and try and push the play. The 5 power plays obviously have helped, but they've looked very good early in game 2.
And we told you the shots on goal, but you saw the scoring chances obviously very much favoring the Dallas Stars. And there was no question the Stars had to establish themselves in this building, where there was talk that there was hardly any playoff atmosphere. One of the Edmonton papers called it an atmosphere like a well-attended preseason game for game 1 in here. The first ever playoff game in this building, of course, second year for the Stars here after moving from Reunion, but did not make the playoffs last year. A little bit of a different atmosphere in here tonight, Ray.
Yeah, it sure is. You know, a lot more people, the start time of the game helps that everybody was able to get here, and, you know, not at work as the game one started early. But we talked to Tommy Salo on ESPN radio yesterday, and he mentioned that it's far easier to play here in America Airlines Arena than it is at Reunion Arena.
Now it comes to Scott Young to the front of the net. Nearly tipped out of midair there by Brendan Morrow.
Brendan Morrow's had a great presence early in the game. Very physical. He's been in on the forecheck. Got a couple of hits early on for the Dallas Stars.
Here is Young controlling. Now it's deflected into the Edmonton zone. Recovered there by Dvorak. Dvorak's been a great pickup at the trade deadline. There's a lot of talk about Edmonton trading their leading scorer, Anson Carter, their top defenseman, Yanni Niedema, while they were still in a battle for a playoff spot. These guys that replaced Carter and Niedema have come in and done an excellent job, including this guy, Corey Cross, that just passed the puck ahead to Dvorak.
Kevin Lowe took a lot of heat at the deadline for the deals, and actually the Oilers played very, very well after the deadline, had 7 wins. Nobody really thought they would be able to contend with their lineup.
Now Holter sends it in deep. Puck is cleared right away by the Oiler defense, but it's over the glass and out of play. Tomorrow night, the quest for Lord Stanley's Cup continues here with a doubleheader on ESPN2 beginning at 7 Eastern. How about the Islanders? Speaking of the 8 seed against the 1 seed, they lead 1-0. Game 2 tomorrow at 7 Eastern, followed by the Blues and the Canucks. Western Conference quarterfinals. Vancouver, a little bit of pressure. Remember, they started the playoffs last year winning twice in Detroit before losing in 6. They're expected to win, certainly by the people in Vancouver.
Well, Dave, they've pretty much had the parade route for the Stanley Cup plan there since November. So I live out in Vancouver, and there's a lot of talk about how disappointing game 1 was for the Vancouver Canucks.
Draw back to Sador. His shot handled by Salo off the right pad. Directed it to the corner. Here's Stu Barnes with it. Slapped away by Salo. He had to be sharp there at the side of the net. Centering attempt again. George Laroque got a stick on it, couldn't control. Here's Barnes. Sends it back on the far side. Ferguson, number 32, taking it for the Oilers, but Dallas Stars come up with it. Now it's taken away by Laroque, and George Laroque looking to clear the zone. Didn't get it by Stu Barnes. And Malhotra upset with himself. He didn't collect that pass.
Another good forechecking shift for the Dallas Stars against the third defense pair, Semenoff and Ferguson for the Edmonton Oilers.
Puck comes free. Pass to the front. Deflected just wide by Barnes. Stu Barnes with a great chance.
Nice play by the rookie Nico Kapanen. Heads-up play. One of the leaders in assists for rookies this season. Really made a nice heads-up play to Barnes.
Here comes Lettinen. They're trying to catch the Oilers on a change. Save made by Salo. Boy, Yuri Lettinen, can he ever shoot the puck? Former Selke Award winner, known as a great defensive forward, but he came through with a big 31-goal season this year. Very capable offensive player.
He certainly is. He does more than check, obviously. He's Dallas's leading goal scorer this year, and he's been a find for them since he's come over from Finland.
Here is Hemsky. Slides it in. Turco, easy stop. Quickly clears it up the right wing side, and it's down to center right. Lead pass for Modano.
1 minute remaining in the period.
Modano roughed up there by Jason Smith. Now Young with a hit on Ryan Smith on the far side. Morrow comes away with the puck. Centering pass, shot, hit it! No, it is in! I was going to say it hit the crossbar, but it is in. However, Don Van Massenhoven is indicating right away that he is going to look at this. He did not call it a goal. But from the reaction of the players, you've got to believe it's in. And boy, again, Scott Young, can he still shoot the puck?
He can, and this is a great play again by Brendan Morrow. In on the forecheck, the puck comes down. Well, look at him, he's got his head up as he controls it. Out Young one-times it, right inside the right post. It looks like Van Massenhoven's gonna take a look at it. But clearly the way the players reacted, this is a great shot by Scotty Young. His second goal of the playoffs, second goal tonight. Number 41 on his playoff career.
Well, they're satisfied upstairs. What a shot by Young. I mean, in and out so quickly. Saw a situation like that last night in the first overtime of the Detroit-Anaheim game when Luke Robitaille hit the crossbar and the post, and they had to review that to determine that it did not go in.
Dallas goal is
and it is a two-goal lead, and you can say that the Dallas Stars have earned this two-goal advantage. Craig McTavish would argue about the 5-on-3s that were created by certain balls. As of this play whistled offside, stay with us. The Southwest Intermission Report is coming up. John Butcher Grass, Barry Melrose back in the studio to talk about all the playoff action. Brendan Morrow and Mike Modano assisting. So Modano's second assist of the game, Young's second goal.
And here's Brendan Morrow back out on the ice. Dave Tippett's going to use him while he's hot here. He's out with Arnott. It's been a very, very good first period for the Dallas Stars, in particular for Brendan Morrow. You don't always have to have points to be effective. He's been one of their better forwards in this first period.
Corey Cross trying to clear the zone. Dallas Stars, Ray, have won a lot of the battles in this first period
that they did not win in game one.
Absolutely. And whatever atmosphere was lacking in game one of this building, as Brad Isbister a bit upset with someone down in the Dallas Stars zone, whatever atmosphere was lacking in game one is evident here in game two. It was up to the players to make sure of that, and they certainly did their job. Marty Riesner got it started. Craig McTavish didn't believe some of the calls, and the Dallas Stars capitalized on their power play. John and Barry on the other side of this.
Morning.
Those are all good, but after cheating on me, he deserves something way more painful.
Tell it over a great tasting, less filling Miller Lite. It's Miller time.
So how's that diet coming?
Oh, my God. Sweet.
Try to get a home equity line from a bank? That's why we started eLoan. It's a better way to get cash out of your house. Needless paperwork? Gone. Lender fees? Gone. Waiting for a decision? Ours takes minutes. At eLoan, we believe everyone is entitled to the right loan at the lowest possible rate based on your credit, not your negotiating skills. You get your cash fast at a great rate. A bank shouldn't come between you and your money. That's why there's eLoan. Apply now at eLoan.com or call 1-800-ELOAN-22.
That's one tough defenseman.
Not bad for a guy from White Bear Lake.
You mean Meadow Lake?
White Bear Lake.
Meadow Lake.
White Bear Lake.
Meadow Lake.
It's born in Moose Factory, Ontario.
I knew that.
For real-time scores, NHL video, and official NHL merchandise, the place to go is NHL.com on MSN.
Welcome to the Southwest Airlines Intermission Report.
Night three of the Stanley Cup playoffs, and the fans really start getting into it.
All three barns
sold out tonight, and the fans going nuts. We begin in New Jersey, who has had some attendance issues this year, but not tonight. They sold out their game two against the Boston Bruins. Devils won game one. Here we go with game two, and Dan McGillis ties the game in the second period for the Bruins. But then Jamie Langenbrunner, odd combination here. Niemeyer down low, Langenbrunner up high.
4-on-3, they get a goal in the first minute of the third period, and they get a goal in the last minute of the first period. Those are two killer things to happen to the Boston Bruins.
Best playoff line in hockey right now.
Oh, playing great.
Neuwendijk with the goal. Friesen and Langenbrunner are his wingers, and the Devil Dogs do it again. They are winners. They held the Bruins, Barry, to just 5 shots on goal in the third.
It was vintage Devils. Marty Brodeur didn't have a lot of work, but he had a couple key saves early in the game. The Devils just shut the door once they got that 3-2 lead.
Brian Rafalski played 25 minutes in this game. He also had a goal. So Devils up 2-0. Now, the Flyers trying to even their series at 1 with Toronto. Before the game, it'll bump Brashear on Domi, and the next time around.
There's not a lot of hair between those three, is there? A lot of toughness, though. Ty Domi saying, geez, I like that necklace around your neck. I think that's what he was saying anyway.
Maybe. Flyers up 1-0, make it 2. Gagne to Roenick, Barry.
Gagne is such a big part of this team since he's come back. He's so fast. Roenick goes to the front of the net. Flyers won all the physical battles. Again, Mogilny was by far the best Toronto player. Guys like Nolan and Roberts, they got to pick it up, boy. This is going to be a short series.
Mark Recchi across the crease. We thought LeClaire got a stick on that. They say Recchi for now. That might change tomorrow. Flyers up 3-1. You knew this was coming.
This was awesome. They've been talking all game. They started in warm-up. Domi, Brashear, two of the toughest guys in hockey, went at it. Place was electric. Nobody left the seats. Oh, man. Take fighting out of the game. You guys are nuts. You're down, man. You went down.
John LeClaire snaps a 10-game playoff goal drought. Flyers now just 4-12 in their last 16 playoff games. Chechmanek just 4-8. So far, so good. They once again outshoot the Toronto Maple Leafs nearly 2-1, and they win game 2 4-1. After 20 minutes, Dallas helped out by a lot of penalties, up 3-1 on Edmonton. More. We'll talk about Canucks and Blues next.
This intermission report, presented by Southwest Airlines, the official airline of the National Hockey League.
Does anybody know the Russian word for loser?
It's Primakov!
Ladies and gentlemen, visiting from Western Russia, the parents of right winger Alex Primakov.
Want to get away? Now you can. Fly Southwest Airlines with fun fares as low as $49 each way.
You are now free to move about the country.
This guy tells his buddy there's nothing he'd like more than a new riding lawnmower. Nothing too expensive, he says, but nothing's gonna give me any trouble. Nothing too complicated. Nothing better than making it look good and getting on with it. His buddy looks at him and says, nothing runs like a deer. Introducing the John Deere 100 Series. Durability, precision, and exclusive support. For anyone who wants a tractor that's easy to run, easy to maintain, and easy to afford.
At a giant store that sells anything, you might find yourself a lawn tractor. But you'll also find Timmy.
Awesome!
At your neighborhood dealer, you'll get a friendly face, expert advice, great service, and the outstanding performance of Simplicity and Snapper products. Powered by Briggs & Stratton engines. So visit your neighborhood dealer and prepare to be impressed.
Awesome.
Play ball! Strike three, you're out!
For everyone.
Sports.
Is the Southwest Airlines Intermission Report.
Welcome back. Second period from Dallas. Back in a moment, but first, some news and notes to tell you about, including more problems for Theo Fleury, the Chicago Blackhawks, suspended a second time. 6-month suspension now. We'll see if the Blackhawks buy out the remaining year on his contract. Calgary Flames fire GM Craig Button, replace him with their head coach, Daryl Sutter, and the NCAA announced that Peter Senia of Colorado College, now a St. Louis Blue, named the Hobey Baker Award winner, the first European to win the award. Well, last night in Vancouver, St. Louis Blues got off to a great start, a 6-0 shellacking of Vancouver. Barry, this Vancouver Canuck team, their confidence is shaken. Their captain, Marcus Naslund, said they choked the final game of the regular season. Now they're getting booed on their home ice.
Well, they weren't good down the stretch in the regular season. That was a bad sign, and you just can't turn good play on and off. And the bottom line is they were dominated last night by the St. Louis Blues. 6-0 really flattered the Canucks. Bertuzzi, Naslund were not effective offensively, and they carried the team all year long. If those two guys don't score, this series is over very, very quickly. I thought Pronger looked excellent, by far the best he's looked since he's come back. I thought Tkachuk was a physical force, so that's great news for the St. Louis Blues. And Osgood, the question mark in net, was very solid, didn't have a lot of work, but boy, he made some key saves, so he looked very sharp. And his confidence will be buoyed because of that easy win in Vancouver. We'll find out a lot about the Vancouver Canucks the next game they play, see if they can come back from that terrible, terrible loss that they had to St. Louis Blues.
And of course, their goaltender, Dan Kluche, has been suffering from a knee injury for most of the year.
100%.
You wonder if he is 100%. And right now, their penalty killing has been poor, the third worst in the league since Christmas, when Matthias Olin, one of their best defensemen, went down with injury.
Well, penalty killing is goaltending, 99% goaltending, and hard work. And right now, Vancouver's not working that hard, and their goaltending isn't very good. So you combine those two things, you're going to have a bad penalty killing outfit.
All right, so game one goes to St. Louis. What will game two bring? Well, you can find out watching right here on ESPN2. Game one, Isles and Senators. Ottawa down 1-0 then. The Canucks try to regroup against the St. Louis Blues, 10 o'clock Eastern, NHL tonight, right after the Blues and Canucks. Scott Young, 2 goals in the first period in Dallas in need of a win. Has a lead, 3-1 after 20.
All right, bye.
Looking for really tough virus protection? Switch to new MSN8. Sign up now and get virus protection that automatically scans your email, plus 2 months free. It's better with a butterfly. Call 866-TRY-MSN8 today.
Give me a backpack.
Thank you.
Tomorrow's special was going to be vegetarian lasagna, but since spaghetti with marinara sauce was served today, the staff did not feel it was appropriate to have two Italian dishes in a row. Therefore, the new special is shepherd's pie and lentil soup.
Real people, real results in 6 weeks.
I'm a whole new person. In just 6 weeks, I lost 20 pounds, which is just fantastic.
I think I lost 5 inches around my tummy.
In 6 weeks, I lost 19 and a half pounds.
Call now to get a free video that tells you all about the home gym that guarantees real results for real people just like you. Bowflex.
Working out with Bowflex was fun.
I was able to transition from one exercise to another very seamlessly.
All it takes is one simple workout, 20 minutes, three times a week.
I like the leg curls. You can just really feel you're working the backs of your legs.
Everything has surprised me. The way I look, the way I feel.
I feel like I can take on the world. You know,
Real people, real results, real Bowflex. Call 1-800-228-3302 to get your free video and brochure and check out the entire Bowflex lineup. That's 1-800-228-3302.
NHL tonight, after the Oilers and Stars. Devils go for that 2-0 lead. More news and notes. E.J. Raddick joins us with Inside Hockey News, and Barry breaks down why the Flyers beat the Maple Leafs. All on NHL tonight.
This intermission report, presented by Southwest Airlines, the official airline of the National Hockey League.
Night's sleep? No big deal? Look again. This x-ray shows no support for your neck and spine when you toss and turn on an ordinary pillow. Introducing the Contour Cloud for incredible support and comfort. See the same person on the Contour Cloud? Neck and spine are straight and supported. That's because of its four exclusive therapeutic features. First, patented soft touch memory layer molds to fit your head, neck, even your ear for unparalleled softness and comfort. Second, yellow wedge provides additional cervical neck support. Third, blue base supports and aligns your spine for a great night's sleep. And finally, this exclusive crescent helps relieve uncomfortable pressure on shoulders. It gently cradles your head and neck. It even cradles your back.
I need neck support, and I used to use that the egg carton type pillow, I think you know what I mean, and there is just no comparison. This pillow is the most comfortable pillow I've ever used, ever.
With other pillows, I wake up, I have numbness in my fingers, I have pain in my shoulder, I'm sleeping on my side, whereas with this pillow here, I wake up, I feel as though I've gotten a good night's sleep.
Watch again how ordinary pillows simply don't support you. Now see how the Contour Cloud cradles your head in softness as it supports and aligns your spine. Thousands have paid $100 for this plain memory foam pillow, but the Contour Cloud is just $19.95. No other pillow combines these extraordinary levels of comfort and support. But wait, call now and we'll double your comfort for just $1. That's right, when you order one pillow at the regular price, you get a second Contour Cloud for just $1. Now you'll have a matching set or use one as a gift. Over 1 million have already been sold at the regular price. Don't miss out. Call right now.
Have your credit card ready and call 1-800-380-3388. Get your second cloud pillow for just $1 plus shipping and handling. Call 1-800-380-3388. Don't wait. Call 1-800-380-3388.
The Stanley Cup Playoffs on ESPN2, brought to you by the 200-horsepower Acura RSX Type S. By 1-800-CALL-ATT for collect calls. It's free for you and cheap for them. And by Bud Light, the proud sponsor of the NHL. the sights and sounds of the playoffs, especially when Edmonton and Dallas get together, and that seems to happen every year. We've completed 20 minutes here of Game 2 of the Western Conference quarterfinals. Dallas leading 3-1. Dave Strader back along with Ray Ferraro. And after Game 1, the victory by Edmonton, some of the Oilers were talking about the fact that they knew this was going to be a tougher game.
Yeah, Georges Laraque mentioned that this would be a much tougher game to win. And actually, Craig McTavish said that it's interesting to see how our team will respond as a front runner. They knew Dallas would come out and play a much better first period than they did in Game 1. They certainly did that.
Second period about to begin, and one of the things that made it difficult, certainly, Ray, for Edmonton to try to establish themselves, they spent a lot of time in the penalty box. There were a couple of questionable calls, but they've got to stay at even strength.
Yeah, they certainly do. They talked about one of the reasons they felt everything went well for them in Game 1 was their poise and their ability to stay out of the penalty box. Well, in the early part of this game, they haven't done it. Dallas 2-for-5 on the power play in the first period and really control all momentum because of those power plays.
Marty Reisner able to clear the puck. Dallas Stars play it back, center ice. Reisner racing back after it. Eric Brewer gets there. Brewer is spun around. Puck is recovered, though, by Reisner, who has the only goal so far for the Edmonton Oilers. With the side of the net, stops it there for Brewer. Crowd reacting to one of the Dallas Stars losing his balance. With it. It's deflected by Scott Young up into the Edmonton zone. Salo tries to clear. Got some help from Ryan Smith coming back. Recovered by the Dallas Stars. Young forced by Ryan Smith. Good job by Modano to keep it in the zone. Now Modano circles back. Centering attempt. Scott Young was open. Bidding for the hat trick. He has two of the three goals. Shot here hits the side of the net. Knocks the water bottle off the top of the net. That fooled a couple hundred fans behind the net thinking it was in. Dubois shot, that's deflected wide. And the puck over the glass and out of play. Mike Modano has picked up a couple of assists so far tonight, Ray, and he certainly is on top of his game.
Mike Modano is just a terrific player, one of the best skaters in the National Hockey League. Led the Dallas Stars with 85 points this year, 28 goals, but he's become a complete player over his career. When he came to Dallas, Ken Hitchcock got a hold of him and molded him, not just from an offensive player, but he wanted him to be effective at both ends of the ice. Modano was great on faceoffs in the first game. He's one of the best, better guys in the league at faceoffs. Modano and the rest of the Dallas Stars have played a very simple game so far. They have not turned the puck up over at the blue line. Every time they get the red line, it goes into Edmonton's zone, and they activate a very aggressive forecheck.
85 points over the course of the regular season, tied for 11th in that category. Rusteos hustling back, doesn't clear. Kapanen sends it in wide of Salo. Smith gets to it, clears it ahead the other way. Here is Hemsky. Pass gets through to Marchand, but he has to turn back the other way. Now jumps it along the end boards. Lovely trying to get something going in the offensive zone. Had only four shots in that first period. Compared to 13 for the Dallas Stars.
And certainly, Dave, a lot of that has to do with being on the penalty kill most of the period, but Edmonton has to go much with the formula that the Stars have done in the first period and a little bit here. Get the puck to the red line and get it in. Dallas has got three guys back at the blue line on almost every rush up the ice.
Jason Arnott has gone to the Dallas dressing room, we're told, just for an equipment adjustment. And we'll keep an eye on his return. Brandon Morrow running to as the puck cleared out to center ice. Mike York has it there, the former New York Ranger. Outstanding forward as it bounced off of his stick into the Dallas zone. This play onside. The shot by Dvorak misses the net. Now sent back by Corey Cross, deflected just wide. That was York that got a stick on that. Now York and Dvorak both in there with Comrie. Hits the side of the net, one of the Dallas Stars. Modano without a stick, going to try to just effectively play defense with the gloves. He was able to do that. Puck is cleared back into the Edmonton zone.
Nice play by Brendan Morrow. He recognized that Modano doesn't have a stick, so he comes from the weak side point about 60 feet away from the puck to come and support the puck to try and help Modano out, who doesn't have a stick and really is not going to be that effective skating around without one. Edmonton gets some traffic to the front of the net, and it's Mike York. The puck goes back to the point. Corey Cross makes a nice shot. You see York right there in front of Matvichuk, and he gets the stick on it. Again, Modano and Matvichuk are in good position, but you can be standing beside a player. You've got to get his stick off the ice so he becomes ineffective. York, who's been one of Edmonton's most consistent players all season long, got the tip in front of the net. Good chance for the Oilers.
Mike York played his college hockey at Michigan, so he might, or Michigan State rather, he probably had something to say to Marty Turco, of course, a Michigan standout. One of the great rivalries in college hockey. Not a bad time to talk about college hockey rivalries with the Frozen Four down to their final two. Here's Brandis Bister now. And a pull away from his check. Is Bister on the backhand? Could not get it on the net.
This is exactly the type of shift the Oilers need, and this is the line that can do it. Horkoff, is Bister, and Larrack had a very good game one. Horkoff had the game winner. This is how you try and get some momentum. Keep the puck deep and keep working the Dallas defense around.
Horkoff also a product of Michigan State. Made that game-winning goal in game one a little bit more sweet against Marty Turco, who he said he never was able to beat in their college matchups.
He said the wait was worth it.
Absolutely. Take those playoff goals in the Stanley Cup anytime. Good work by the Oilers deep in the zone, and now Dallas trying to draw George Larrack into retaliating. Here come the Stars on a rush. Salo kicks it right back to the corner.
Interesting play by Salo. He wanted to get the rebound out of the front of the net, but he put it right back into the traffic, so the Oilers are going to be able to escape unscathed.
Ferguson now for Edmonton to center ice. He'll get it deep into the Dallas zone. We play 4.5 minutes here of period number two. It's a 3-1 lead for the Dallas Stars as Yuri Lehtinen plays it back inside the Edmonton zone.
Another defenseman back there, Marty Turco. You see when he put the puck right up the board, 75 feet away.
There is Zuboff getting a shot away as the Oilers couldn't come out completely. Zuboff back to get it, plays it off the inboard. Hatcher moves it around to Miles. Look out, big hit coming from Jason Smith. And back comes Kapanen the other way, gets a shot away, a little steered aside by Salo. Now Zuboff at the right board. And it knocked away, 2-on-1 here, Marty Reisner. He's got Pisani on the far side, hands it across. Pisani shot on a save by Turco. He was aggressive coming out to cut that one off. Oilers still have it though in the Dallas zone. Kapanen gets to it, tries to clear.
Great save by Marty Turco, his best save tonight. Nice play from Reisner over to Pisani, and Pisani got good wood on the shot, but Turco was equal to it. He got across the net very strongly.
Now Young wristing it into the Edmonton zone. So the Oilers come back with a little bit of a push, and it all started with that fourth line with Larrack and Horkoff providing an Isbister some energy for Craig McTavish's team.
That was really the first turnover that Zuboff made at the blue line. It's going to be a Dallas penalty here, but that was the first turnover that Zuboff made that led to the 2-on-1. Dallas has not made many tonight.
It'll be Edmonton Oilers with a chance now on the power play. Brendan Morrow can't quite believe it.
You see Reisner's got his head up. He's looking past the whole way across. You see Turco gives it one push across the front of the net and makes a pad save on Pisani. Look at him on the southwest goal cam here. Get across. Look at the positioning. His glove right on top of his pad. He smothers the bottom part of the net. The only place that puck can go into the net is right under the shelf, and that's a very difficult one-timer for Pisani to get up there. Brendan Morrow picks up the penalty. Edmonton back on the power play.
They are 1-for-2 with the main advantage so far tonight with a couple of shots on goal. And the goal was scored by Reisner. Stars had one chance to clear, didn't do it, but on the second effort, Stu Barnes makes sure, gets it out of there. Turco coming back aggressively to play that puck and then moves it quickly. And the Stars able to clear it.
Dave, there's not many goaltenders in the league that can do that. Ron Hextall was really the first guy that got out of the net and played it like that. That dump goes around the boards. Edmonton gains control.
Jason Arnott is back to the Dallas bench. He's taking care of whatever the equipment problem was. Edmonton continues to work now with the man advantage. Here is Comrie doing his Craig McTavish impression. He's playing without a helmet. McTavish was the last player to play without a helmet in the NHL before he retired. Now Dvorak sends a shot in, deflected by Turco. York with a wraparound attempt that was stopped. Now it comes to Dvorak again. He'll play it back to the line, but it was tipped. And Marchand has to go back and recover. Now Brewer carries into the zone. Has it knocked away. DeBio able to clear. Corey Cross settles it down from behind his own net. Over a half minute, you see remaining on the Dallas penalty. Oiler dump it in. Horcroft trying to get his stick free, could not. And it is cleared.
The puck gets dumped into the Dallas zone. There's two Oilers on the puck. Dallas has three guys on it. Edmonton has to outnumber on the power play every time the puck gets dumped in the corner. If Dallas has two guys there, Edmonton needs three guys. Now they chip it in and they go offside. Radek Dvorak was one of the players come over at the trade deadline from the Rangers in the Anson Carter deal. He's got a good shot. Look at him use Philippe Boucher as the screen here. He shoots it right through his legs. Turco makes a nice save, deflecting it behind the net. Dvorak's one of those guys that can add offense, instant offense, to the Edmonton Oilers. You see, since the trades, when really you would think that their goal scoring would go down because they traded Anson Carter and Nienema, their goal scoring has gone up by almost half a goal a game.
A lot of people questioned the moves that were made by the Oilers. Everybody thought it was just financial, but they've been very happy with the return they've gotten from Isbister, Dvorak, Corey Cross.
I played with Kevin Lowe in New York. He's a very smart hockey man.
That shot just snuck through but went wide of Turco. Teams are back at full strength. Pass to the front of the net, deflected away, and Stu Barnes able to steer it to Jason Arnott. Arnott now. At the red line, dumps it in for Brendan Morrow. Steo's trying to stay with him. Jason Arnott plays it up the board. The stick came up and caught Brendan Morrow in the face inadvertently.
Yeah, Steo's was turning around and his stick caught Morrow right in the face.
Oilers get control. Outlet pass. Need the Morrow rink wide. And Pisani will backhand it into the Dallas zone.
See the rink wide pass. There's not many times against the Dallas Stars that rink wider is there. And if it is there, the player receiving it more often than not is by himself because of the system that Dallas plays in the middle of the ice.
Turnover here by the Stars. Larocque coming in on the backhand, turns to the forehand, sends it to the front. Stars get back in good defensive position, and Stu Barnes will clear it down the ice. They'll take this icing here on the touch-up by Semenov. You've got to be ready no matter where you're on the ice at playoff time. Things like this can happen.
Introducing a new level of performance from Acura, the all-new TSX.
Alex, there's something I want to ask you. Will you make a collect call by dialing down the center with 1-800-TALLATT? It's free for you and cheap for them. Can you get this? I forgot my wallet.
Save on every call. Dial 1-800-CALL-ATT for collect calls.
Here it is. Actual ice from the Boston Guard.
Oh, let me smell that.
Nice.
How much?
$200. It's an investment.
Yeah. Oh, game's on. Oh, let's go.
You know, they won the cup on that.
American Airlines Center, 10:53 remaining here in the second period, game two, Western Conference quarterfinals. Tommy Salo getting ready down at the other end. He has already been beaten three times, twice on the power play. Special teams have been a big factor. Oilers' only goal coming with the man advantage. Marty Reisner in the first period. Dave Strader along with Ray Ferraro. John Butchergrass, Barry Melrose back in our studios. Dano able to clear here for the Dallas Stars. Goes off the stick of Brewer and into the seats out of play.
The Dallas Stars.
Eric Brewer is one of the fine young defensemen in the National Hockey League. The Edmonton Oilers absolutely stole him in a trade from the New York Islanders a couple of seasons ago. He's big, he's mobile, he was an Olympic gold medal winner this past February in Salt Lake City with the Canadian Olympic team. Played 26 minutes in game one. Eric Brewer's from a small town in British Columbia. He never played rep or all-star hockey until he was 15 years old. So it shows you the development that this kid's made in a very short period of time.
Approaching the halfway mark of the second period. And you can't always tell what kind of a hockey player a kid's going to be just by how he plays when he's 8, 9, 10 years old. I know you know about that, Ray. You've got a 15-year-old goaltender. Can't believe a goal scorer like you has a son that plays goal, as we're going to have a penalty indicated here. Denny LaRue making the call. Well, tomorrow ESPN has the NCAA Frozen Four Division I Hockey Championship. New Hampshire takes on Minnesota for the championship on ESPN at 7 Eastern. New Hampshire upset the top seed Cornell, and they'll go for their first title. Minnesota defending champs got by Michigan in overtime. For more, log on to ESPN.com. Lanny Garrett, New Hampshire's leading scorer, will not play because of a dislocated shoulder.
Kirk Muller's going to take his second minor of the night, a holding the stick penalty. And what was really odd about this is you're going to see the play go into the corner. Look at he puts Cross's stick under his arm. In the past, you could get away with that, not today's game. But what was really interesting is about three or four guys were standing around. Everybody was unsure of who had the penalty. It indeed is Kirk Muller.
Oilers' second power play of this period. Their fourth of the hockey game. Here comes Ethan Morrow with some speed into the zone. Had it knocked away. Brewer in front of his own bench.
No need to carry the puck in when you have the power play and try and beat a defenseman one-on-one. That's what you need, right? Is a soft chip down the board. Get the defense to turn and go get the puck with some effort and set the power play up.
Oilers forced all the way back into their own zone here to regroup. 40 seconds off the Muller penalty, and Oilers finally get it in the zone. Big hit there by Hatcher. Now the Oilers get it set up. It comes out to the line. Marchand holding it in. Sends it in off the inboards wide for Ethan Morrow. Now Reisner tries to poke it to the line. Marchand a shot, kind of flubbed it up in the air, and it's knocked down. Back to the line, held in by Brewer. Dubov rolls it back, intercepted by the Oilers. Nobody in front, though, to receive a pass. Now Brewer hands it off. Here is Reisner, back to Brewer straight away. He fakes, hands it off for Marchand. Marchand tried to center. DeMaio gets to the loose puck, and Rob DeMaio able to clear.
Eric Brewer got that puck to the middle of the ice. It's a great shooting position. He didn't think there was enough traffic there, so he held on to it and moved it over to Todd Marchand. Marchand's out of a shooting area. Brewer's got to be more aggressive and shoot that puck.
Weather's not able to enter again. 20 seconds remaining in the Dallas penalty. They wave off the icing. Leif Boucher looking to clear. It'll be held in on the far side by Steos. Steos, and it's knocked down in front. Soft shot. Turco, though, able to make the stop. Ryan Smith centering. Pal Turco, did he make a save there? Boy, did he go down in an acrobatic move and get the glove up in the air. I couldn't tell if the shot got to him or not.
Turco went with the two-pad stack there. He's a little bit unorthodox in goal sometimes, but another good save.
Stars back at full strength, and this will be icing here on the touch-up by Steos. Oilers fail on the power play. It remains 3-1.
ESPN HD, sponsored by Phillips and Best Buy.
Introducing a new level of performance from Acura, the all-new TSX.
So close, within a hair, but not quite there. The hair stays for April Savings Day. Right now, get savings up to 10 grand or financing as low as zero APR on Toyota, Honda, Jeep, Lincoln, Mercury, Subaru, Mitsubishi, Hyundai, and more. If you're in the market for a new car, the Bob Romanato Group is here for you.
There's only one Bob Roman.
The Bob Romanato Group, Sagamore Parkway, Teal Road, Creasy Lane, Lafayette.
Come on, David. Come on, David.
Let's go, David. Come on.
Come on, David. You got the love.
Get as involved in your kids' education as in everything they do, and imagine the success they might find. Stay in touch with the teacher. Visit the school. For more tips, call 1-800-281-1313.
Go, David! Go, David!
Welcome back to Dallas here. You're going to see a great save coming up by Marty Turco. Ryan Smith holds the puck, reverses it out front to Dvorak. Turco gets a two-pad stack. He's made a couple of very good saves. That's one of his two best ones of the night.
Weren't quite sure when we saw it live from about five floors above the ice as we are here whether he made the stop, but indeed he did.
Not only are we five floors above here, Dave, it's when you're short like me, it's a long way from the rink. I can barely see over the edge.
Stars come back the other way. It is dumped deep into the Edmonton zone. Intercepted, centering pass here. Oh, and a sliding save there by Salo.
Nice save by Tommy Salo. Again, Dave, the Dallas Stars, they make a chance out of a dump in off the rush. They don't try and overhandle the puck. It's a very simple play. It goes into the corner. Nice play out of the corner by David Oliver, who's in the lineup today and replacing Claude Lemieux. Gets it to the front of the net to his old teammate, Jason Arnott. But a good sliding save again by Tommy Salo.
Here's a look at David Oliver on the left, Jason Arnott on the right. Oliver, his 120-goal season came in Edmonton earlier in his career when he was a teammate and a line mate of Jason Arnott. Dave Tippett hoping to rekindle some of that old chemistry. David Oliver, another University of Michigan product.
A lot of Michigan guys not very happy that their alma mater went down in the semifinal at the Frozen Four in Buffalo.
Nails and Modano continue to battle. Zuboff, centering pass. He knew he had a teammate coming to the net. And it forces Edmonton to take a penalty. And Brendan Morrow's hooked to the ice. Is there going to be a second call or just the one? It looks like just the one. And the Dallas Stars are going to go to work on the power play. Darian Hatcher asking about that second hook during the delayed call.
Well, you can always ask about it, but not often do you get it. Here you see Brendan Morrow driving the net. Ryan Smith got a step behind Morrow and had to pull him down, and there he hooked him down. I guess there could have been a second call, but you're not going to get that very often. Dallas has moved the puck so well on the power play. They've looked so confident. And this is a big kill for Edmonton. You don't want to drop down three goals here to a very good Dallas Star team.
Power play number six for the Dallas Stars. Who have scored two of their three with the man advantage. Been a much better atmosphere here at American Airlines Center for this game two than there was apparently 48 hours ago for game one. And now the crowd chanting Salo, Salo to try to get on the nerves of the visiting goaltender. See the numbers on the Dallas power play rate.
Yeah, Dallas starts their second unit here. And again, as I said early in the game, without Pierre Turgeon and Bill Guerin in the lineup, this really hurts their second unit. You've got guys out here that don't play that much power play time, although Barnes and Dallin do play from time to time, but they're not going to score anywhere near as proficiently as Turgeon and Guerin would.
Not often you get to put on a big hit when you're on the power play, but Darian Hatcher had a chance there, and he knocked Marty Reisner down to the delight of the crowd. Modano tries to get going with some speed, but Horkoff did a good job of slowing down.
Darian Hatcher talked about the intensity was not there in game one. He's done his part by being very physical tonight. He's got three or four very good hits. You're going to see Hatcher playing the point on this unit on the power play as well.
Jason Smith trying to chip it out of there for the Oilers. Held in by Modano. Dangerous pass tipped away. Masani trying to cut through. But Modano was there to slow him down on the playoff side.
As we said, Darian Hatcher has tried to make his presence felt in a physical manner here. Reisner's got the puck. He dumps it away. A lot of times, as you mentioned, shorthanded, you don't think you're going to get hit. Here it is at live speed. Hatcher lays the boom on him. Reisner gets spun around. He made a good play. He's looking behind him for a penalty call, but good hit by Darian Hatcher.
Under a half minute remaining in the Edmonton penalty. Philippe Boucher, who did not play in game one, back in the lineup here in game two. The series will shift to Edmonton for games three and four next week. Now Young with it. Gets it back out to the hash marks. Rink wide pass. Sidor back. He comes to the slot again on a right skate save by Salem. Great puck movement. Set up Scott Young for what would have been his hat trick. Back the other way. The Oilers get control. Steos bangs it off the board. Dvorak is out of the box and the pass did not quite get through. And Ryan Smith, excuse me, is out of the box. And Brendan Morrow dumped to the ice in the neutral zone and very slow to get up.
Took a knee from Jason Smith. Yeah, Morrow fell as Smith stepped up for the hit. He was lucky it's not a more serious injury.
Here's Dvorak. Dvorak now takes it wide, looking for some help. Throws it in on Turco. Capita got there for the Stars. Clears it ahead. Rob DeMaio now to Lettinen, who sidesteps a check. Semenov, number five, steps in there for the Oilers.
The Oilers now, they had a nice penalty kill here. They have to get back some momentum, and they really need it from some of their big players. We haven't seen much of Comrie and Smith offensively. The most pressure they have has been their fourth line.
Ryan Smith trying to get that puck out from underneath Robidoux, who I think is the one that lost the stick down there. And now a pile up on the puck, and everybody getting involved. They're trying to. Crowd here at American Airlines Center coming to their feet. Starting to heat up again late in the second. 3-1 Dallas.
And now the toughest leg of the strongman competition, Norm. The Bud Light Industrial Fridge Pull.
Jim, that's 1,000 pounds of pure hernia that they'll try to drag across.
Sorry to interrupt, Norm, but it looks like a fan from the stands has stolen the Bud Light. Oh! A huge hit from out of nowhere. And this guy's got the foot speed to take this thing all the way. Oh, man!
Come in, bro!
For the great taste that won't fill you up and never lets you down.
Okay, who's the hero?
Make it a Bud Light.
Introducing a new level of performance from Acura, the all-new TSX.
Papa John's, after 19 years, no question, it's an amazing pizza. Why is our original crust pizza made from fresh, hand-tossed dough? Why gourmet, baby portobello mushrooms? Why 100% real cheese and sauce made from fine, ripened tomatoes? Why? Because I said so.
Celebrate Papa John's 19th anniversary. Get two large one-topping pizzas for just $11.99. Call us now. We'll be right there.
Better ingredients, better pizza. Papa John's.
Back in Dallas with the Stars leading 3-1. A scuffle right before the last whistle. If you wonder where it started, there it is right there. Ryan Smith checking out how Stefan Robidoux is doing. And Robidoux got up and punched Smith. And I can imagine he's pretty upset, but... this is going to be a big chance for the Edmonton Oilers. Robidoux, even though you're not happy with what's happening, you can't retaliate. Oftentimes, whenever there's a scuffle, the penalty that's going to get called is the second motion that's made. And yeah, Smith probably should have had a penalty there as well, but it's not going to get called. Robidoux can't get up and retaliate.
I'm not sure what they would have called what Ryan Smith did to him, but Robidoux's in the box by himself. It is a power play for the Edmonton Oilers again with a chance to get back to within one. If they can do that, the way this second period has unfolded, and Ray be just one good shot away from tying this thing up going into the third, I think the Oilers would have to feel pretty good about that.
I think they would feel very good about it because there's been some problems for the Oilers, but they're still in the ball game right now.
And it looks like a penalty's going to even things up. Let's get to our 1-800 call ATT storyline. Scott Young with two goals tonight. Mike Modano with a couple of assists.
A storyline replay is going to involve Scott Young. Scott Young has the two goals for the Dallas Stars. Played a very effective game so far tonight. Here's the first one. A great pass from Daryl Sidor. Young tips it through the five hole. And this is more what I know of Scott Young as a player. Quick one-time shot off Brendan Morrow's perfect backhand pass. Two goals in the first period for Scott Young. Exactly what the Dallas Stars needed coming out of the gate here in game two.
34 by Zanin.
2 minutes for holding the stick at 16.
Orlando Pressani for holding the stick while on the power play. That should not happen.
Oh, it shouldn't happen. 5 seconds into the power play, he's killed the Oilers' chance on the power play here. Inexperienced rookie mistake by Pressani.
Well, four skaters aside, and right now Craig McTavish has Hemsky number 83 along with Horkov number 10 up front. Brewer and Corey Cross are the defensemen. They're up against Scott Young, Mike Modano, Arian Hatcher, Sergei Zubov. Hemsky carries it back toward the line, now dumps it in deep. Horkov pinned to the boards there by Zubov. Under 3 minutes remaining here in period number two. Dallas trying to tie this series up at one. Oilers trying to grab a 2-0 lead.
Mike Modano didn't see Scott Young on the change there. Edmonton was changing defensemen. Young would have had a clear-cut breakaway, but Modano didn't see him.
NHL Gamecast with live scoring, shot charts, and game stats is the best way to follow the action of every NHL Stanley Cup playoff game. NHL Gamecast available now on ESPN.com and NHL.com.
Scotty Young throws the puck to the front of the net here, and he almost gets a bounce off of Tommy Salo. Young came over as a free agent in July, one of the four signed in the offseason by Doug Armstrong and the Dallas Stars. He had a horrendous struggle at the start of the year. It took him a while to find his game. Actually had a lot of success later on in the season playing with Jason Arnott and Pierre Turgeon.
There was Philippe Boucher, and you talked about him being back in the lineup with that excellent shot from the point. He had a pretty good opportunity there. Now Salo saw it all the way.
Boucher has a very heavy shot. You see this playoffs, all of them with the Los Angeles Kings, just one goal, but he's really turned into an effective two, solid number 2, 3, 4 defenseman. He can play in either of your top pairs.
Here is Jason Smith handing it off for Steos. About 20 seconds difference between the Robidoux penalty and the Pisani penalty for the Edmonton Oilers, this playoff side.
Todd Marchand's had a terrific year for the Edmonton Oilers. He's an unrestricted free agent at the end of the year. He had career highs in goals with 20 and assists with 40, 60 total points. He's always been a checker, a penalty killer, always relied upon for the Edmonton Oilers in the defensive role. You see he's got 7 goals in 37 playoff games, including that dramatic game winner that we've seen a couple of times tonight in Game 7 at Old Reunion Arena.
Another product of Kyle Itakki out of Clarkson. Todd Marchand. Robidoux getting set to come out and give Dallas a brief 20-second power play, but it's coming at the right time. The puck is deep in the Edmonton zone. Centering pass. DeMaio got tied up. Here's a shot by Sidor that goes up over top of the crossbar. Boucher moves in. Hands it off in deep. It comes back to the line. DeMaio, he drives the shot through. Traffic stop. Loose puck up in front of the crease. Recovered by Marchand. And as he is falling, able to clear. And that'll do it for the Pisani penalty. He skates hard over to the bench. Oilers back at full strength.
Last minute and 20 seconds of the period here. The Oilers do not want to give up another goal. It would be crushing to their chances here. Dallas will try and hold the puck. There's Ulf Dahlin again. He does it so well behind the net.
Ulf Dahlin controlling it well, as Ray mentioned. Center pass, score! Jason Arnott, the recipient of the hard work of Ulf Dahlin. It is a 4-1 Dallas Stars lead.
Well, we said that the Edmonton Oilers don't want to give up a goal in the last minute in the period. A terrific play by Ulf Dahlin. Shows great patience behind the back of the net. He holds it. He slides it through Eric Brewer's feet. Corey Cross cannot get back and handle Jason Arnott going to the net. Ulf Dahlin was another one of the free agents that came over in the offseason. Arnott's an addition that came at the trade deadline last year. This team's been totally made over. It's a far more dynamic team than under Ken Hitchcock. But Ulf Dahlin, one of those guys that doesn't get a lot of credit or a lot of notoriety, but very, very good behind the goal line in the offensive zone, taking the puck to the front of the net.
Well, Edmonton had a couple of power play chances to get back to within one, and they failed to take advantage. Let's go to the studio. John DeBerry, guys.
All right, how about Stu Barnes down low there?
Stu Barnes any credit, man.
Hitting that dude.
Should have got a penalty, really.
How's Chicken Parm doing in his debut?
Doing great. Just don't talk over a goal, Ray.
Cardinal rule number one. Good job, Parm.
How is Darren Pang lasted so long if you can't talk over a goal? Pangers called a couple this year, I think. No, well, you've done a good job, partner.
Well, thanks. I'll tell you, it's a lot different watching the game on TV and then coming here to try and talk about it. And the one thing Barry did say, he says, look, you know, you try not to talk over a goal, and you probably will, but just don't.
Well, it's a lot tougher out here. You don't have your own makeup person, sit there watching all the games and just relaxing. This is more work out here.
I try not to let my buddies know that I'm now a complete makeup wearer, so if just keep that under wraps, Grades, that'd be awesome.
4-1, Dallas Stars have taken command of this game. Well, they still have 20 minutes of work to do, but they have worked hard here tonight for the first 40 minutes.
Dallas is in their trap here, a 1-2-2 trap. There's no room through the middle of the ice. Edmonton has to push the puck up the board.
Turco just got that puck across.
He doesn't seem to know sometimes he's in a playoff game. He couldn't be much cooler back there, could he?
He certainly has bounced back. Not that he's been tested a lot, but he made a couple of very difficult saves. And now here we got Jason Schmidt going after Yuri Lehtinen. And you know that's going to draw a response to Darian Hatcher.
I don't know that they'll call this a fight. Had it elevated into a fight, you may have had an instigator penalty on Edmonton. Tempers are going to be short here with a 3-goal lead going into the third period. Expect a physical third period as Brad Isbister jumped in.
Yeah.
And, you know, he came to Hatcher's, or came and tried to jump into Hatcher's problem with Jason Smith. Hatcher was trying to help out Yuri Lehtinen. That's how things kind of escalate. But look for Edmonton to try and play a physical third period. It's only game two. It's a long series. You have to show that you're going to be counted throughout the entire series.
Just play the game, says Captain Jason Smith. It is going to be a long series, and I have a feeling, just based on what we saw, it's going to be a long third period. Oilers are not out of it, but the longer it stays like this, we'll see more of what we saw at the end of the period. 4-1 in favor of the Stars.
Introducing a new level of performance from Acura, the all-new TSX.
Scientist's wife and son are kidnapped to save them.
Give up!
Sydney Bristow must first save herself.
If we don't walk out of here, nobody does.
Alias 98 Central. Then a rich man's son is kidnapped.
His kidnapping could be political.
And ransom is due.
$10 million.
But that's just the beginning.
The kidnapper has the wrong boy.
So who was kidnapped and why?
You can't afford to lie about anything.
Detective Friday must risk his own life to find out before it's too late.
I'm begging you, please.
New Dragnet after Alias, all starting 98 Central AB.
This is the deal you've been waiting for. Right now, go 0 to 60 at Bill Andrews GMC Truck and Oldsmobile. You'll get 0% financing for up to 60 months or $3,000 in rebates on every new GMC and Oldsmobile. There's a huge selection at Bill Andrews waiting for you with over 150 new 2003 GMCs and Oldsmobiles, and you'll get 0% for 60 months or $3,000 in rebates on each and every one. Choose from our huge inventory and go 0 to 60 at Bill Andrews GMC Truck and Oldsmobile, State Road 38 East, Lafayette.
A mi Juan le cuesta mucho hacer la tarea. ¿Cómo puedo ayudar?
By coming here, you're already helping. Teachers have a lot to learn from parents.
Dice que ya con venir aquí estás ayudando. Que los maestros tienen mucho que aprender de ti.
By the way, he's been a little mischievous lately.
Dice que me porto requete bien.
Juan.
Hables inglés o no, debes participar en la educación de tu hijo. Aprende cómo llamando.
Welcome to the Dodge Intermission Report.
With former Toronto Maple Leaf defenseman Barry Melrose, I'm John Butchergoss. Welcome to the Dodge Intermission Report. Said Maple Leafs up one game to love on the Flyers game two. Some pregame jocularity between Ty Domi and Donald Brashear.
I love this series, man. This series got everything.
Friday night fights in Philly will bump Brashear on Domi the next time around.
Intense game here for Flyers. They're taking it in the papers. They got to show up. Ty lets them know that the Toronto Maple Leafs are ready to play also.
1-0 Flyers make it two. Gagné to Rona.
So different with Gagné in the lineup. That speed he possesses. He backs everybody off. Rona had a strong game going to the net.
Alexander Mogilny, the only Toronto goal, his fourth of the series.
Best makes it 2-1. Again, John. Best player again was Mogilny. Guy that really heated up to is John McClair. He really looks the healthiest and the freshest he's been for a long, long time. And we waited for this. We knew it was going to happen, and it was a good one. Not many fights in the playoffs anymore, but when the big boys go at it, toe-to-toe, it was excellent, man. The place was electric. The place was on fire. Ty sent a message that we'll be back for game three, and you went down.
John McClair snaps a 10-game playoff goal drought. Gagné, an 8-game playoff drought. Recchi, a 7-game playoff drought. And the Flyers are winners, and they even the series 4-1. Well, game one in Ottawa the other night, a bit of a shocker. Garth Snow, first career playoff shutout in the Isles, win game one over the Sens. And Jacques Martin and the Sens said they were awful, just awful. They didn't deserve to win.
Well, I'll tell you, the Philadelphia Flyers were challenged in the papers and by their fans, and they responded tonight and played unbelievable, dominated from the top of the whistle to the end of the game. Now it's up to the Ottawa Senators. This team was embarrassed. They won the President's Trophy. Alexander Yashin walked into his old house, showed more guts than the whole Ottawa team put together. Now, if this team does not come out tomorrow night and play their best game they played all season long with fire, with passion, with physical play, going to the net, winning every battle there is, that dressing room has no guts at all, because this team has been called out. They know their history. They know they've never played well in the playoffs. It's time for this team to put up or shut up.
And many feel Martin's job is on the
it
line.
It should be. If Jacques Martin does not win, he should be gone.
All right. Jason Spezza didn't play in the first game. Neither Jody Hall. We'll see if there's any lineup changes by Ottawa like we saw in Dallas tonight. All right. Here's your doubleheader on ESPN2. Isles and Sens. Sens need a win to even the series before they go back to that rock and roll rink on Long Island. And then Blues and Canucks. The Blues spanked Vancouver in game one 6-0 last night. The Canucks need an equalizer.
They were lucky to have nothing.
After 40 minutes, those Dallas Stars. They got their A game tonight, 4-1 over Edmonton. More hockey talk right after this.
This intermission report, presented by Dodge, the official road team of the NHL. Grab life by the horns. Dodge.
Hi, Mary Beth Hoyt here for The Handy Stitch, the sewing solution for today that makes sewing fun, fast, and easy. The Handy Stitch uses the latest microtechnology and actually fits in the palm of your hand. It does the jobs that conventional sewing machines can't, so you can sew anything, anywhere, at any time. It has the precision of a small machine to repair delicate fabrics like silk, yet has the power of a big machine to sew through tough fabrics like denim. Whether you're a beginner or an expert, the Handy Stitch is for you. You can even do repairs while wearing your clothes, repair a pocket without taking your pants off, fix a fallen hem in the office in no time, even use it for patching up outdoors. It's quick around corners and can add a decorative touch to all sorts of fabrics. You would never be able to sew draperies with a regular machine. The Handy Stitch is a portable sewing solution that makes life a little easier. It lets you put the professional touch on your home decorations and will pay for itself over and over. It gives you that genuine chain stitch, which means you get a secure, strong, and even stitch every time. It's battery powered or AC adaptable, so you can sew any fabric, anywhere, anytime. Because of its compact size, it travels with you. The Handy Stitch can even be used outside to repair a flag or fix an awning.
Regular machines are bulky and can cost over $500. Call now and you'll get the Handy Stitch complete with 4 threaded extra wide metal spools, the needle threader, and an extra spool pin for regular size thread. A $40 value for just $14.99. But call in the next 5 minutes and we'll also include this giant 64-piece thread and bobbin collection, so you'll always have the right colored thread for any job. A $20 value, yours free. That means you get everything. The Handy Stitch, all the accessories, and the 64-piece thread and bobbin collection, an incredible $60 value, all for just $14.99.
So call this number right now. Here's how to order.
To order the Handy Stitch for $14.99, call 1-800-546-3443. That's 1-800-546-3443. So call 1-800-546-3443 and order now.
Stanley Cup versus Niagara Falls. Let's see who attracts more attention. Here it is. That's right, you're not seeing things, folks. Yeah.
Pretty cool, huh? This is your wedding present.
Awesome. Can we just take that?
Is it pretty?
Want to get your name on there?
A real cop?
Check that.
Are we ever lucky?
Is this like the eighth wonder of the world?
This is the Dodge Intermission Report.
No one gives the Devils much of a chance in the East. They're not talking about them.
No, and I think that's good for the Devils. I think they like that, just coming in under the radar.
Up one game to nothing on the Boston Bruins. Game two tonight, and they sold out New Jersey rink. 2-1, Devils. Boom. And McGillis, what a wrist shot over the right deltoid of Martin Brodeur. And we are tied at two. But then very early in the third, 4-on-3, Barry. Boy, 4-on-3, such a much bigger advantage than 5-on-4 power play. Maybe, Langenbrunner.
Maybe the best player in the playoffs of anybody right now. Langenbrunner makes a great shot. Now right here, Langenbrunner makes the
pass.
Neuendijk. And Neuendijk goes in and throws it up right up under the bar. Oh. Put some icing on the cake, John.
Holy shnikey, what a backhander. So there you go. Those Devils, they're up 2 games to love. They've never lost a series when down 2 games to love. And, of course, the big reason why is they have Martin Brodeur.
Yeah.
When they're up 2 games to love.
Bottom line, so tonight, everything happened right for the Bruins. They got out. They got the lead very, very quickly against New Jersey, which is very important. They got the line matchups they wanted. Everything was going their way, and they still couldn't keep the lead. They gave up a goal with under a minute left in one period, and they gave up a goal in the first minute of another period. Two cardinal sins you cannot allow happen. And the New Jersey Devils, they lose the best defensive player in the world, Bobby Hulik, and they're still the best defensive team in the world. How do you figure that out? Marty Brodeur has some of it, but you got to give guys like Madden and Turner Stevenson and Pascal Rion some credit.
They've played 164 playoff games in franchise history. Cam Danico has played them all. He's good. Never missed
one. It's one of the reasons they win.
Jason Arnett, former New Jersey Devil. He scored the game-winning Stanley Cup goal against the Dallas Stars. Now he is a Dallas Star, and he gives the Dallas Stars a 4-1 lead after 40.
Vacation program. Come to Arkansas. For your own free Arkansas vacation planning kit, call today.
Shaking me off.
I want to bring the heat up to announce my presence with authority.
To announce your what?
To announce my presence with authority.
Announce your presence with authority. This guy's a first ball fastball hitter. He's looking for heat.
Oh, yeah? So what? He ain't seen my heat.
All right, me. Give me heat.
Baseball tonight, all season long on ESPN and ESPN.
His desire made him a champion. Now his pride gives a dangerous opponent one last shot at greatness. Marco Antonio Barrera.
It's about honor.
Kevin Kelly.
Barrera is mine.
For the featherweight championship of the world. Barrera versus Kelly. Saturday, April 12th, live on In Demand Pay-Per-View.
Get your ringside seat on In Demand Pay-Per-View.
It's about winning.
Bring it on.
Know that the first person to fly faster than the speed of sound was Chuck Yeager back in 1947?
No.
I didn't think so.
It's fun to know history. Find curious facts from America's past at loc.gov, the Library of Congress website.
Dodge Intermission Report, all your hockey on ESPN, ESPN2, and ABC. ABC, Wild Avalanche, Muddy Ducks, Red Wings, Capitals, Lightning. Check your local listings. Barry Melrose in between periods with John Saunders. ABC Hockey, Stanley Cup playoffs tomorrow.
This intermission report, presented by Dodge, the official road team of the NHL. Grab life by the horns. Dodge.
There's only two ugly people in the world, and your mama's both of them.
You know, your mama's so fat, she stepped on a dollar and made change.
I heard your mama's so ugly, she robbed a bank with no gun, just stuck her head over the counter and said, put that money in the bag.
Stick them up. Stick them up.
Timing was a little off.
Oh, timing was a little off.
Timing was way off.
You're not
just
funny.
Tell it over a great-tasting, less-filling Miller Lite. It's Miller time.
Up top.
At a giant store that sells anything, you might find yourself a lawn tractor. But you'll also find Timmy.
Awesome!
At your neighborhood dealer, you'll get a friendly face, expert advice, great service, and the outstanding performance of Simplicity and Snapper products, powered by Briggs & Stratton engines. So visit your neighborhood dealer and prepare to be impressed.
Awesome.
Just relax. Try to think of something simple like making a collect call by dialing down the center with 1-800-C-A-L-L-A-T-T. It's free for you and cheap for them. Okay, my turn.
Save on every call. Dial 1-800-CALL-ATT for collect calls.
This is the Bowflex Power Pro. Quite possibly the most effective home fitness machine ever made. Bowflex is so effective that we guarantee you'll get the results you want in 6 weeks or less. You can own a Bowflex with no money down and payments as low as $33 per month. Call and ask for a free video and brochure, or visit us on the web today. Redefine your body with Bowflex.
Did you miss any of this year's NCAA games? ESPN Classics got your chance to see three great games from this year's tournament, including Syracuse's first national title win. See this triple instant classic starting 5 p.m. Sunday only on ESPN Classic.
The Stanley Cup Playoffs on ESPN2, brought to you by Miller Lite. Life is best told at a place called Miller Time. And by Dodge, the official road team of the NHL. Grab life by the horns, Dodge. The way the second period ended, and Brad Isbister ended up getting a double minor. Darian Hatcher just a single minor. So another power play for Dallas as we start the third. They lead it 4-1. Dave Strader back along with Ray Ferraro. We talked at the very top of the show about Darian Hatcher, the importance of a captain. He took a bad penalty at the end of game one. Didn't feel the team was intense. He's brought it tonight.
He certainly has it. Darian Hatcher's not a real vocal guy, so you're not going to get any Vince Lombardi speeches from Hatcher. He's going to do it with the body. You saw him lay out Marty Riesner in the second period. This is on a Dallas power play. He's made a physical presence all through the night. Another guy who I think's been the most visible Dallas forward outside of Scott Young's two goals is Brendan Morrow. Here he draws a penalty on Ryan Smith. He's had several hits in the offensive zone. He's worked the puck behind the net very well, and he made a perfect pass to Scott Young on Young's second goal.
Three goals sounds like a lot, maybe impossible against this Dallas team, but you still got 20 minutes to work, yet they take that extra minor, so now they start out shorthanded again.
It's certainly not going to help their chances. And, you know, in game one, Edmonton did a great job of staying out of the penalty box, and they really felt that was one of their keys. You want to keep this Dallas power play off the ice as much as possible. It's going to be the eighth time that Dallas heads to the power play.
Well, this experience, does it become more of a factor as the game wears on and the series wears on? Certainly the Dallas Stars have a huge advantage coming into this game. Nearly 1,700 combined games of playoff experience. The Oilers much less.
It certainly does make a difference. Of the 1,699, though, remember that only one of those is Marty Turco.
That's right.
He's doubling his playoff total tonight in his second game. He hasn't had a lot of work, only 10 shots, but he's made three pretty good saves in the net. He's been good when he's had to be.
Sixth time in the last 7 years these two teams have met in the first round. And there's only five players, three Edmonton Oilers and two Dallas Stars, that have played in the preceding five. O'Donnell, Sedor, and Matt Tkachuk for Dallas, and Ryan Smith and Todd Marchand for the Oilers are competing for their sixth time against each other. A Sedor shot deflected wide by Salo. And a pass up the middle, nearly got through, intercepted though by Zuboff. And here is Young with it. He sends it back to the point. Sedor has it there. Back to Zuboff. Stars settle it down now with a man advantage. Puck comes free. And they try to clear. Corey Cross couldn't get it out of there. He tries to rough up one of the Dallas players, Brendan Morrow, in front. Ooh, Brendan Morrow and Tommy Salo going at it a little bit behind the play.
Four or five times tonight, the Oilers have had control, good control of the puck on the penalty kill, and they can't get it out. That's another way they haven't been anywhere as sharp in this game as they were in game one.
DuBarn sends it back. Time winding down on the Bister penalty. And has given Dallas their eighth power play of this game. Shot from the right side, stopped by Salo, and he hangs on.
Tommy Salo's done a great job in goal for the Edmonton Oilers, but he's gotten lucky a couple of times. Here's Sedor with the shot. You see Todd Marchand going out to block it. You see it deflect off his stick. It's right off the crossbar. Oh. Salo has no chance here. The shot, the deflection by Marchand. The goaltender doesn't want you to try and block it unless you're going to block it. If you think you're going to deflect it, they would rather you just leave it by. Marchand's doing the best to get out there that he can. All that ended up happening there was he turned a relatively harmless shot into a very dangerous chance for the Dallas Stars.
25 seconds remaining on this Dallas power play. Here was Sedor. And on the far side, Ulf Dahlin had been bumped offside into the Oilers zone. Jason Arnott with the goal late in the second period. Jason Arnott going to the front of the net where he is so tough to handle, as you see his career playoff numbers.
Jason Arnott with the cup winner with the New Jersey Devils at Old Reunion Arena. Yes. Against these Dallas Stars back in 2000. Big acquisition last year by the Dallas Stars right after Doug Armstrong took over. They really had that trouble trading Joel Neuwendijk and Jamie Langenbrunner. But to get a player like Arnott, they had to give up some pretty good quality players.
Well, I guess you could say that trade has worked out for both teams tonight, because we saw what Langenbrunner and Neuwendijk did in game two of the Devils series against Boston, taking a 2-0 lead in that series. Here's a quick chance that Salo turns aside off the stick of Jason Arnott. Hemsky was serving the first minor penalty to Bister. He is out of the box. So the Oilers are back at full strength. Boucher, that is steered aside by Salo. Sedor comes in from the point, wins the battle, gets the shot away. Salo makes the save. Edmonton Oilers with only 11 shots on goal.
Pretty difficult to generate chances when Dallas has been doing exactly that all game, getting the puck below the goal line and working it so effectively.
That bounces off of David Oliver, tries to regain control, could not. Oilers have it. And now Ferguson sends it in wide of Turco. Obada gets there for the Stars. Outlet pass, here is Oliver. Hands it off on the near side, a little bit behind DeMaio. Hustles back to get it. Now the pass for Lettinen to Kapanen, and he backhands it in wide. Now Kapanen sends it back across. DeMaio just fanned on it. Centering pass again. Here is Kapanen with it. Great work by this line. Kapanen, Lettinen, DeMaio. Now DeMaio again, hands it off. It comes back out now to the hash mark. Lettinen with a shot. Salo the save, and he has it long enough to get the whistle.
Terrific shift by Yuri Lettinen, Nico Kapanen, and Robbie DeMaio. Kapanen, fourth on rookie assist this year. Look, he gets a great pass through the entire box. It goes across to DeMaio here from the Southwest Airlines goal camp. DeMaio gets a good chance on the net, but he doesn't get it on the net. He misses the side of the net. DeMaio had a great chance in game one that somehow went through the other side of the net with a little bit of puck luck. Rob DeMaio can have 8 playoff goals in 45 games. He's got 6 in 44. He's a tough right winger, very versatile for the Dallas Stars.
Stars control the draw. Sedor dumps it in deep. Dale's tied up by Kirk Muller. Pass here for Malhotra didn't get through. Now Malhotra taken down hard to the end board. Tries to send it out to Stu Barnes and it rolls to center ice.
A 4-1 lead in the third period allows Dave Tippett to play his fourth line a little bit more. Try and economically get Medano on the ice, not use him so much in a game that you're going to need him a lot more minutes down the line.
Big collision, Larocque and Sador.
Sador's given away about 40 pounds to Big George on that one. You can run at him as hard as you want. You're not going to move him too often.
Oh, and another hit on Sador. That time it was Jason Smith that came across.
It's a tough shift for Daryl Sador.
Up the right side. Brendan Morrow takes a run at him. The puck comes back the other way. Morrow goes to the front of the net. He slides it across. Shot scores! Brendan Morrow to Mike Modano. 5-1 Dallas.
Brendan Morrow has been the most visible forward on the ice, in my opinion, for the Dallas Stars. He's done everything. He's made two perfect passes. First to the Scotty Young's goal, here to Mike Modano. And Modano can fire the one-timer as well as anybody. Look at Morrow. He uses it through the stick of Steve Staios, who's really in a desperation position. Perfect one-timer. And now you're going to see the Dallas Stars go into the trap. As tight as anybody, there's not going to be much room if Edmonton's going to try and pass the puck side to side in the ice.
Second of the playoffs, scored by
second goal of this series. He had the only goal for Dallas in game one, his 47th career playoff goal.
And you know, you take a look, Modano scores the goal. Dave Tippett takes the break back off the ice. He's not going to overplay them in the third period. You're going to get a chance to rest your big guys for further on down what's going to be a very physical series.
Scott Young getting an assist, so a three-point night for Scott Young and also for that man, Mike Modano. The Stars have certainly responded after the performance in game one.
They've been terrific right from the get-go tonight. They've been far the better team, and obviously when you have a four-goal lead, you are the better team.
Don't forget that Edmonton started the scoring in this game with a power play goal. Zuboff, nifty move to get by Hemsky. Still hangs out on the puck, cut to the middle, and couldn't quite get the shot away. Here's a steal by Barnes. It comes right up between the circles. Hatcher misfired on the shot. Barnes nearly able to get to the rebound. And Zuboff sends it across to Hatcher. Has to go to the bench, get a new stick. Zuboff with it. Gives it off to Stu Barnes. Barnes takes a look, snaps it wide. It goes high off the glass as Tommy Salo took a swing at Brendan Morrow as he went by.
Holy fuck!
Now Barnes with it. Sends it back into the Edmonton zone. Ethan Morrow. No, I guess they're not going to go. Morrow tried to get Brendan Morrow to go for the bait, but he wouldn't take it. Well, you better keep your head up now. Doesn't matter which color jersey you got on. Somebody on the opposite side comes near you. You better be ready.
You know, Dave, Turco went out of the net and actually made a little bit of a body check behind the net. That's why the goalie shouldn't be allowed to be touched, or should be allowed to be touched when they leave the crease.
It is starting to heat up. 5-1, the Stars in control.
Some people don't realize how many nonstop flights Southwest offers, so we created this simple color-coded map to help. Baltimore to L.A. is red. Phoenix to Raleigh-Durham, blue. Chicago to Seattle, yellow. L.A. to Austin, canary yellow. Orlando to Albuquerque, teal. Las Vegas to Houston, aquamarine. Buffalo to Phoenix, beige umber. San Jose to Baltimore, pistachio. Oakland to Chicago, sea green. Albany to Orlando, puce. Tampa to St. Louis, pinkish. New Orleans to San Diego, kinda green.
You are now free to move about the country.
Don't mess with Dodge Ram, Durango, and Dakota. Part of the most powerful, longest-lasting line of trucks.
Ram Heavy Duty. Enough muscle to grab Motor Trend's 2003 Truck of the Year award.
Morning.
Those are all good, but after cheating on me, he deserves something way more painful.
Tell it over a great-tasting, less-filling Miller Lite. It's Miller time.
Well, not a surprising move by Craig McTavish, the coach of the Edmonton Oilers. Jussi Markkanen, the backup goaltender, is going to see his first playoff action. Nothing Tommy Salo can do to turn this thing around, and he was starting to get involved with players skating by. Craig McTavish probably figured, right, you know what, I'll let him start to get ready for game three, and why not give Markkanen a chance to experience the playoffs?
Really good move by McTavish. There's no point in leaving Salo in there. I don't think that Dallas is going to play Mike Modano very much. They're guys that you need for the long course of the series, and you might as well get Markkanen some play in goal. He played very well down the stretch for the Oilers.
Ethan Morrow took a double minor penalty. So the Dallas Stars working on power plays 9 and 10.
I don't think there's much chance of winning any games when you're in a penalty box 10 times. I know there's a little frustration factor going on here, but the Oilers are going to really have to regroup.
Here's a shot, score! Markkanen's first shot, he faces, ends up in the net, and it is a 6-1 Dallas lead. Great play on an earlier goal, gets a reward here.
It's all going wrong for the Edmonton Oilers right now. The puck gets dumped around the boards. It pops right out in the slot. Dallin gets a quick shot away before Markkanen can get his stick down from the Southwest Airlines goal cam. You see the shot go right through the five hole. Perfectly placed by Ulf Dallin. The key to that, get the puck on the net quickly. Don't take so much time trying to hold it. Another power play goal for the Dallas Stars.
Comes to center ice before Stu Barnes could get in there to get it. Semenov steps in front of him and the puck cleared over the glass and out of play. Well, the one thing, I guess, if you're the Edmonton Oilers, you can say this loss, whatever the margin turns out to be, 6-1, doesn't count any more than our 2-1 victory. If you're Craig McTavish, you certainly came in here after winning game one, trying to win game two, but now you go home, and still you have home ice advantage.
You still have home ice advantage, but the trick for Craig McTavish is going to make the point to his players that, look, guys, we should be confident. We went into Dallas and we won one game. You can get your confidence shaken when you get blown out in a playoff game, but you're right in saying it's just one game. It doesn't, 1-0 to 7-1, it doesn't really matter.
Unassisted goal by Ulf Dallin, 15th of his career. It is a 6-1 Dallas Stars lead. Bergeson able to clear the zone here for the Oilers. And the Dallas Stars, Boucher, and Kirk Muller, and Emil Holtzer now trying to make a move. Stu Barnes knocks it away from Bergeson. And just think, when the Dallas Stars get Pierre Turgeon and Bill Guerin back in the lineup,
they're really the deepest team outside of Detroit, I think, top to bottom, when you look, when everybody's healthy and in their lineup. The Guerin return, to me, is going to be the question mark. I just don't know how effective he's going to be if he's able to make it back this season.
David Oliver holds it in for Jason Arnott. He sends it rink wide. Zubov, bouncing puck, now sends it toward the net. It's blocked by Steos, cleared to the board. And going to be a call of a high-sticking penalty, it looks like. A reminder, tomorrow, catch exciting first-round playoff action from the Stanley Cup on ABC, presented by Nextel. You'll see game two action between the Mighty Ducks and Red Wings. Ducks leading that one 1-0. Some will see the Wild and the Avalanche, with the Wild up 1-0 in that series. Or you'll see the Capitals and the Lightning, Washington, leading that series. That's tomorrow at 3 Eastern, noon Pacific. Check your local listings for the game in your area of the Stanley Cup playoffs on ABC, presented by Nextel.
28 Oliver, 2 minutes for high sticking at 8:15.
2-minute penalty against David Oliver.
Yeah, Oliver for high sticking, Steos for slashing. Right towards the last corner battled in. Steos took a swing at Oliver after he'd high stuck him and his stick shattered. Really, the referees are going to call things probably pretty tight here.
And another penalty coming. Oh, and Corey Cross took a shot at the Dallas player. He took down on that, brings everybody into the fray. Marty Turco, the Dallas goaltender, is at center ice taking a look at UC Markkanen, and Markkanen's talking to him.
I don't think Markkanen's going to leave the crease here, but now you've got Ryan Smith wrestling around with Nico Kapanen. You know Kapanen doesn't want much to do with that. Eric Brewer's got his man tied up against the boards here. Ryan Smith has a guy in a position where he just doesn't want to be, and that's Kapanen right now. Marchand's holding his guy, but Corey Cross has the original penalty. And you know what? As big as he is, I don't know that Corey Cross wants to get into it with Robbie DeMaio, who's probably one of the tougher guys in the league. Robidoux's going to try and help out Kapanen here. He skates over there with Marchand to try and get Kapanen out of the grasp of Ryan Smith.
All of this happening with the team skating four aside.
Robbie DeMaio and Corey Cross are going to the penalty box, and there's such a size mismatch that you would think that Corey Cross would have the upper hand, but DeMaio is one of the toughest guys that you'll ever see. He has surprised many a big guy in his career.
Well, let's take a look at the original penalty as Corey Cross was taking Robidoux here. That's the original call, and it was on the delay that the rest of it all happened.
And I would suspect that he's going to get another one right there. And here comes Rob DeMaio flying into the fray, and shortly after, everybody else will jump in. This is where it's really difficult for the officials now. The game is close to getting out of hand. They're going to have to call it very tightly, Dave. Now they're trying to figure out the penalties the best they can, and really what they'll try to do with the calls as the game goes on is to send a message to the players that no more is going to be tolerated. We're going to call everything on the ice, try not to let the game just get completely out of control.
This kind of intensity is what you can expect as the playoffs continue here on ESPN2. A doubleheader tomorrow night beginning at 7 Eastern. Michael Peck and the Islanders will try to make it 2-0 against the Ottawa Senators beginning at 7 Eastern, 4 Pacific. And then it'll be the Vancouver Canucks on their home ice trying to even things up against the St. Louis Blues. Western Conference quarterfinal action that begins at 10 Eastern. Taking a look at what has happened so far in the Eastern Conference in that 1-8 matchup. The Islanders with that much talked about 3-0 win in game one. You heard Barry and John discussing it in our second intermission. New Jersey leading 2-0. Washington with a 1-0 lead, and Philadelphia getting the win tonight to even their series. And Ray, in the West, I guess you could say surprises everywhere.
Unbelievable night of hockey last night. J.S. Jaguar, 63 saves in Detroit in the overtime battle with the Anaheim Mighty Ducks, who win the goal on a late Paul Kariya goal. Colorado had 18 shots in the first period of Minnesota's Dwayne Rolison. Rolison was terrific. Minnesota gets three quick ones and puts the Avalanche away. And nobody would have thought that St. Louis would go and destroy Vancouver on their home ice 6-0 as they did. Chris Osgood picked up at the trading deadline with the shutout in last night's game.
Well, there's going to be a lot of sorting out to do here, and it's going to be not an easy job for Denny LaRue and Don Van Massenhoven for the final 11 minutes and 27 seconds of this game.
Well, Robidoux and Cross have gone to their locker rooms, and a lot of times what officials do here and what you may see these two guys do is every time there's a scuffle, there's going to be close to 10 minutes left. They're going to give misconducts at this point, and you're going to see guys disappear one by one to the locker room. And that's how they try and keep the game under control.
Well, you see the two captains, Darian Hatcher of the Stars on the right, Jason Smith on the left. They're the only two representatives of their teams that are allowed to come over and listen to the officials' explanation after the officials have relayed the information so that it can be announced on the public address system here at the arena. Don Van Massenhoven explaining what their ruling is.
You know, that was one of my favorite things about being captain in Atlanta. I got to go over and talk to the referees, and they actually had to listen to me. Before, they kept telling me to go away and be quiet. But I loved being able to go over and talk to, in particular, Paul Stewart, because nobody was better than Stewie than tell me to go beat it and go do something else. Stewie was very entertaining. He's going to retire after this year. Over 1,000 games for Paul Stewart. He had a terrific career.
Absolutely, and fought a courageous battle and won against cancer, and has been very involved with the Hockey Versus Cancer fundraising efforts through the National Hockey League. Well, the explanations have been made. Robbie DeMaio saying, hey, I got away with it. I can go back sit on the bench.
Sometimes it's good to be small. Maybe, maybe the guy they call Sal hit himself underneath the big guys and he didn't get a penalty out of it. So Jason Smith will go back and explain to Craig McTavish and Charlie Huddy, two great teammates with the old Oiler dynasty, what's going on. Now Dave Tippett's getting the explanation from Hatcher. Tip's got a question, and he wants Darian Hatcher to go back and talk to the officials about it.
All this happened with the Stars' David Oliver in the box for a previous penalty, and Ethan Morrow was in there as well for the Edmonton Oilers.
This is frustrating at times when you're a player. You just want to get the game going again, but there's... You know, everybody's got an explanation of what's going on. Now, Massenhoven's over talking to Tippett. Tippett's not happy about, it appears as he's not happy about one of the penalties called on Edmonton. Now, Van Massenhoven's trying to explain that Turco came out of the crease, and if he called Turco for coming out of the crease, I think it's the wrong penalty because Turco was coming out to play the puck under the late penalty anyway.
Well, again, a reminder on ESPN, the NCAA Frozen Four Division I Hockey Championship is down to two teams. New Hampshire takes on Minnesota for the championship, 7 Eastern. New Hampshire got there by defeating top-seeded Cornell. They'll be going for their first title. Minnesota, the defending champs, got by Michigan in overtime in the other semifinal game. For more, log on to ESPN.com. The NCAA Division I Hockey Championship tomorrow from Buffalo.
Nico Kapanen and Ryan Smith head to the locker rooms as well. I assume their penalties will be because they were the second altercation and after the first one had started. And again, this is what happens when games get out of hand. You're going to see a 4-on-3 power play here for Dallas as Corey Cross has taken a major for the cross check down on the ice to Kapanen right beside the goal. So the Oilers are going to be shorthanded pretty much for the remainder of the next session here. 5 to 6 minutes are going to be shorthanded, and this game is quickly deteriorating and sliding out of control.
Darryl Sedor trying to verify that it is a 4-on-3.
This is one thing as players we've never been able to figure out. they hand us this rule book at the start of the year and it becomes a paperweight because nobody reads the thing. And now, whenever there's coincidental minors, and they had changed the rules back and forth between 4-on-4, and then sometimes it would go to 4-on-3, none of us could quite figure it out. And you see Sedor's asking here. Now, Van Massenhoven is wearing a track out to go to Dave Tippett, and now he's going to have to go and explain what's going on again.
Well, Edmonton should have 3 skaters out there. Dallas should have 4. And the Ethan Morrow penalty showing 7 seconds will expire to bring him out and make it 4-on-4. And then when Oliver comes out, they'll get the power play back and there will still be 3 minutes and 18 seconds on the major penalty to Corey Cross. So there's going to be a power play, of course, barring another breakout, which is...
Well, Cross got a 5-minute attempt to injure penalty, so that's going to be something that's going to be under review. He picked up a double minor as well.
2 minutes for roughing and 10 minutes misconduct.
Smith and Kapanen with the minors and misconducts for that second altercation.
2 minutes for leaving the crease.
And they blew the call on Marty Turco. Turco was going to play the puck on the delayed penalty. The puck was already out at the blue line when he played it.
Yeah.
And Turco will pick up a penalty for that.
So now they have the players out on the ice.
17.
And the count is right. I think the penalty timekeeper, though, is asking whether the right number of players are in the box.
They're going to have to get somebody to serve Turco's minor, and it's going to have to be somebody that was on the ice. So they're going to have to try and go through who was on the ice at that time if there's anybody left from the altercation.
So for Dallas, Kapanen got a 2-minute penalty plus 10. Robidoux got a 10-minute misconduct. Turco got the 2 for leaving the crease. And for Edmonton, it was Corey Cross that got 2 for roughing and then the 5-minute major. And Ryan Smith got a 2-minute penalty as well.
Scott Young was in the penalty box, and now you see Robbie DeMaio is going to go over to the penalty box and serve the minor because DeMaio was on the ice.
Well, they're going to try to figure this out, and we'll be back to finish this one up. 6-1 Stars.
boy.
Hey, Bill. Good job, man.
Rusty, what's your hurt?
Hey, I'm just trying to get home, man.
Introducing the Dodge SRT Series. Race inspired, street legal.
Sweet.
The Masters boasts one of the most coveted prizes in all of sport, the green jacket. Players will tell you that winning here is about more than just skill and experience. It's about becoming part of history. But one thing remains true in Augusta. The grass is always greener when you win. The Masters, live April 10th and 11th on USA. See it for the first time in crystal clear high definition on a special feed of USA Network.
Menards is your complete door and window store. Choose from over 144,000 window styles and sizes by Carradco, with a natural wood interior and durable aluminum clad exterior, all on sale at 15% off. Save big on Wayne Dalton insulated steel garage doors with pinch-resistant panels. This 9x7-foot raised panel door is $259. A 16x7-foot model is $429. Get quality and value at Menards.
Save big money at Menards.
Well, they have it figured out. We think four skaters out there for the Dallas Stars, three for the Edmonton Oilers. Still 11:27 left in this one. The Stars are going to even this series. I think that's safe to say at a game apiece. UC Markkanen has replaced Tommy Salo after the fifth goal, and Markkanen gave up a goal on the first shot he faced. From Ulf Dahlin, they've added an assist to Jason Arnott. Morrow's double minor has expired, so now it'll be 4-on-4.
Back in,
now it comes back along the board.
Switch.
It goes back down to Vinny Malhotra, who is upended. Oilers regain control. Really sure why the Edmonton Oilers have four skaters on the ice, because the one penalty didn't start. There's still two penalties up on the clock.
If this is a too many men on the ice penalty coming up, or what's going to end up happening is the player was let out of the box by the penalty time.
You know what happened? Yes, that's exactly what happened. You know what it is that the Ethan Morrow penalty expired. He should not have come out of the box. He should have stayed. And at the same time, that next minor penalty, you could never be three men short in hockey, just in case you don't know that. You can be two men short, and then if another penalty is called at the same time, well, that one has to be delayed. And so when Ethan Morrow came out on the ice, the Oilers were guilty of too many men on the ice, but I don't know that they'll be penalized for that. And I'm not sure how the officials will remedy this unless they'll put the time back on the clock and go back to the start of the 2 minutes for Ryan Smith that's up on the clock.
Denny LaRue and Don Van Massenhoven, their fun meter is right about at zero right now. They are done explaining the rules here to just about everybody in the building. They just had to go over and explain them to the timekeepers. Obviously a mistake was made, but you're right. It should still be a 4-on-3 power play. The penalty to Corey Cross has 6 minutes left. And
there you can see the four skaters for Edmonton. Far right of your screen, the two up at the top and over on the left.
Well, they've just taken the minor to Ryan Smith off the board, meaning it must have been a coincidental minor along with the Nico Kapanen minor that would cancel out. So in that regard, it is going to be a 4-on-4, and there will be no further penalties.
Yeah, so they were right to let him out. They were wrong to put it up on the board. So that even made it more confusing. Well, based on what was announced, that makes sense. So each team had two minor penalties. Corey Cross had the 5-minute major with the attempt to injure, and we're going to have another penalty called here.
This is a simple call for both LaRue and Van Massenhoven. When you have both officials raising their arm at the same time, you know that you've been caught. Big George Larac was back-checking through the neutral zone, and the obstruction that we've heard about all season long, Larac broke pretty much every rule you can have here on the back check. He didn't skate. He had his stick through the midsection. Big George had three pretty good hits in this period. He's going to try and make a presence in the last 10 minutes of the game, but his presence will be felt in the penalty box here for the next couple of minutes.
the Dallas Stars getting together to talk about their strategy on this power play. John Buttigieg mentioned in that second intermission, as we saw a highlight of a Devils goal against the Bruins on a 4-on-3 power play. It's not a situation you practice a lot. It happens more often in the regular season when you have that 4-on-4 in the overtime, right?
It certainly does. And you know what? It's very difficult for the penalty killers to try and cover the ice. What they try and do is front the shot as much as possible. And what that means is they're going to try and get out in front of the shooter so he changes his mind and he'll make a pass. It just goes from bad to worse for the Edmonton Oilers.
Yeah.
You know, the Oilers have taken a bench minor now. So you've got the two penalties on the board. When one of them expires, then the next one can start. They can't start coincidentally, so it's a 4-on-3 for at least the next 2 minutes. And if they don't score, it'll be for the next 4 minutes. And you don't see Young and Modano and Zuboff. Well, Zuboff is out there. You don't see Young and Modano up front, and you're going to see some other guys get some power play time from the Dallas Stars.
This is not a box score you're going to want to try to figure out when you're looking at your morning paper tomorrow with your cup of coffee. But the Dallas Stars are going to have a 5-on-3 here shortly. And Hatcher into the zone. And they have scored on a 5-on-3 already in this game. Goal by Zuboff. They tied the game at 1. As it comes back to Hatcher at the line, he sends it across. Now Zuboff switching spots there with Hatcher. Barnes getting some power play time. One timer on the way. Nope, comes right back. And out of the box now comes Oliver. Now a 5-on-3 again for the Dallas Stars. Here is Hatcher with it. Takes a look across Zuboff. Settles it down. Hands it off for Oliver now at the hash mark. Straight away is Zuboff. Zuboff hands it off on the far side. Hatcher takes a look. Doesn't pull the trigger. Back to Zuboff. One timer. Deflected through. Marking in the save.
Dallas is breaking sticks like crazy. Hatcher had a one-timer earlier on. Zuboff right there. They both break on the one-timer. You work so hard to get a good chance, and your stick shot is in your hands. It's very frustrating.
One-timer on the way here. And Markkanen stops that one off the stick of Hatcher, who gets it right back. He looks for Boucher. Boucher, a one-timer. That was knocked down in front. Cleared to the board by the Oilers defense. Drew Barnes will give it go there with David Oliver. Barnes sends it straight away. Boucher back to Barnes, top of the circle. Boucher takes a look, doesn't have a clear path. Now it goes to Hatcher. Hatcher across to Boucher to the faceoff dot. His shot deflected before it got in on Markkanen. One of the Oilers lost a stick.
Edmonton's penalty killers are exhausted.
Comes to Hatcher. Hatcher a shot. That was blocked. Excellent timing of the drop to the ice there by Alexei Semenov, playing in just his second career playoff game. And a whistle here. And do we have too many men on the ice for the Dallas Stars?
Dallas had about 9 guys on the ice as they were making a change. And unfortunately, Boucher threw the puck right back to where everybody was changing. A call that pretty much had to be made, I guess.
Ray, I can imagine you've been in this situation on a bench at 6-1 and some guys that don't normally get power play time. Dave Tippett's obviously giving some guys a chance. You see about 9 sets of legs come over the boards and they're ready to go.
You can't be much more excited to get on the power play than a game like this. You know this might be your only chance in the playoffs, so you're trying to scramble out there as quick as you can.
The Oilers still have the 2 men in the box. As the penalty to York on the bench minor just goes up there. Kirk Muller is onside. Into the boards there by Ferguson. Manny Malholtra tried to pass it back to the point. It was blocked. Malholtra has it again. Avoids most of that Jason Smith check. Well, the Oilers get to it. It is cleared down the ice.
Hold on. Marty Turco's going to play the puck here. He hasn't had much to do, only 11 shots tonight in the Dallas goal. In just the second playoff game. He doesn't look nervous handling the puck, that's for sure, does he, Dave?
No. 7.5 remaining in this one. That's that goal in game one. Oilers had a slight advantage, and look at the Dallas Stars, 34-11 in this game. But again, it only counts as one win, whether it's 6-1 or 2-1. And there's the hit by Eric Brewer stepping up on Rob DeMille.
DeMaio carrying the puck through the neutral zone. Solid hit by Eric Brewer. He's a big, mobile man, and as we talked about him earlier, absolutely stolen from the New York Islanders in a trade a couple of years ago. Brewer's a young guy. He's going to be 24 years old in 6 days. You know, he's got a lot of growth to do, yep. And this guy's going to be a star in the NHL. He's got a presence on the blue line that just doesn't come around very often.
Here is Hatcher sliding it across Boucher. He gains the zone. Sends it in deep, Markkanen knocks it down, but couldn't control it. David Oliver takes a hit there from Semenov. Malhotra sends it out to the line. Boucher, now to Hatcher, top of the circle. Trying to pass it in front, intercepted. And here is Comrie with it. He'll take it to center ice, takes a hit as he sends it into the Dallas zone, and Comrie looked hard into the board. And look out, here comes Jason Smith. He went after the Dallas player that put the check on Comrie, and everybody getting involved again.
And Jason Smith, trying to send a note to the Dallas Stars that you can't hit our best players. Philippe Boucher, a clean hit on Mike Comrie. Comrie has not been much of a factor in either games one or two. He's played 7 minutes and 20 seconds in the first period. First two periods, he had one shot, but really, if Edmonton's going to be effective in this series, Mike Comrie has to be very effective. You see him here kind of scuffling around with Manny Malhotra. But Comrie was hit. He had his head down a little bit, and Boucher stepped up on him in the middle of the ice. See, he's got his head down. He wants to dump it in, but Boucher finishes his check. Comrie loses his
good
balance.
Clean hit.
Oh, good hit by Boucher. Comrie jumps up, and Jason Smith came from the blue line and jumped on top of Boucher. And, you're basically trying to send a message just to leave our star players alone.
Well, we were just going to get down to a manageable situation with only one penalty up on the clock, but that's going to change.
These guys in the penalty box are going to be getting new pens pretty soon because they got to be out of ink. Jason Smith having a little fun with the guys hanging over the glass in the penalty box. I'll tell you, there's always some entertainment if you're the guy in the penalty box as the player. But there's always lots going on between the guys hanging over the glass and yourself.
Well, Jason Smith is heading to the dressing room. He is done for the night.
Well, there might not be any hot water left by the time they get back there. Edmonton's down four guys already.
Yeah. He dusts it off in behind the net, gets the signal, steps, feeds him the
puck. He meets Corey Cross, and then skips a backhand pass. Another conference going on here as we look at the guys hanging over the bench.
Yeah.
And I don't know what they're yelling at Alex Hemsky. I'm pretty sure Hemsky's not going to have too much of a retort. He's
19 years of age in the Czech Republic.
Yeah, he's 19-year-old. I'm sure he's not worked on his witty repartees at this point in his career.
Mike York is having plenty to say to the fans back there.
And now Brad Lazarowicz, who is one of the linesmen, he's getting security to get these guys off the glass. You remember last year, some guy fell in the penalty box in Philadelphia, and Ty Domi ended up taking a round out of him. He's actually, in my opinion, in rather a comical development. He's going to sue practically everybody involved in that situation, I guess, for being a donkey and falling in the penalty box and getting beat up, that he's going to sue Ty Domi and the security at the arena. Here comes the security here, and somebody's night is about over.
Well, they're going to escort those guys out that were having the conversation with the Edmonton Oilers in the box. Six minutes, 30 seconds on the clock. Dallas Stars are going to even this series at a game apiece.
They'll head back to the good ice in Edmonton, Alberta,
yep.
where Edmonton has had a lot of success on the road in this history of the playoff series. The Oilers and the Stars, the Stars have played very well in Edmonton.
This is going to snap a five-game playoff losing streak for the Dallas franchise, of course. They did not make the playoffs last year, and their playoff run in 2001 after they beat Edmonton ended in the second round when they were swept by the St. Louis Blues. A reminder again, tomorrow night here on ESPN2, the quest for Lord Stanley's Cup continues. A doubleheader will begin with the Eastern Conference quarterfinal series between the Islanders and the Senators at 7 Eastern. Senators trying to even things up on their home ice before the series shifts to New York. And then we'll head out west at 10 Eastern for the St. Louis Blues and the Vancouver Canucks. The Blues lead that series 1-0. For more information, log on to ESPN.com.
Dallas penalty, number 43. Boucher,
now they announced the penalties here, and
Dallas penalty number two.
Four skaters for the Dallas Stars, three for the Edmonton Oilers. Now becomes a 5-on-3 as Holt Dahlin steps out of the box.
Oilers
there's still about a minute 50 seconds remaining on both of the Edmonton penalties. Here is Holt Dahlin with it. Dahlin sends it out to the far side. Zuboff setting it up now with the 5-on-3 advantage for the Dallas Stars. And Orville the drive. Whoa, that hit the crossbar, I believe. And as Markkanen realized that it got by him. Rink-wide pass, Dahlin sends it out to Zuboff. Zuboff, Sidor on the points. Dahlin in the corner. Kirk Muller behind the net. And Emil Holtra in front. Markkanen the save, and he hangs on.
Elf Dallin's had a pretty good hockey game for the Dallas Stars. Very good behind the net. We saw him make a terrific play on the Jason Arnott goal at the tail end of the second period. He drew a penalty early in the first period. And there's Mike Modano sitting on the bench. He's probably going to need a pillow or a backrest pretty soon because I think his night's pretty much about done. He's right about here is when you start thinking about taking the tape off your ankles because you know you're not going to get out there too often and your feet are starting to fall asleep.
Jason Smith got the 2 minutes for instigating, 5 for fighting. Boucher got 5 for fighting. And a 10-minute misconduct to Darian Hatcher. Now they're trying to figure out which guys they can let out of the box. Scott Young will see a little bit of time as he tries to get a playoff hat trick. His two goals in the first Dallas period gave the Stars a 3-1 lead.
2-minute minor penalty being served by number 11, Alf Dahlin. Time of the penalty, 14-18.
And there was a penalty call there on Dallas, a bench minor.
A 2-minute bench minor for the
Lions. Here is Jump with a drive. Markkanen got a piece of that. It may have been deflected on the way in. They were called for a delay, maybe, in getting the proper guys out on the ice for the faceoff. Oilers get to it. Here is Eric Brewer with it. Brewer into the Dallas zone. He's going to take it in. Backhand shot. Chuckle the save. And he made it look acrobatic, maybe more so than he had to. But the crowd enjoyed it.
Turco does that a lot. He moves around a lot in the net, but he seems to have pretty good positioning. He went down to a two-pad stack. He didn't really seem to need to do that there.
Got to the front of the net. Eric Brewer knocks it away. Zuboff. Backhand pass across the zone to keep it alive for the Dallas Stars on this power play. Here is Kirk Muller with it. Sends it back to the point now for Scott Young. Young straight away takes a look, sends it far side. Zuboff back to Young. One timer on the way. Markkanen able to get across to make that stop.
They're obviously looking for Young here. Every time Zuboff gets the puck, he takes it down the side and tries to get it back to Young for the one timer.
They're looking rink wide for Young. And the Oilers anticipated that. And Brewer will shoot it all the way down.
Oh, would you look at this? It looks like Edmonton's going to be back at even strength.
And the Edmonton Oilers now actually have the man advantage because there's still time remaining in the Ulf Dahlin penalty. Stamos has it for the Oilers. It is sent in by Ferguson, and that ended up in the Dallas bench. And out of play. Brendan Morrow, as you pointed out, very solid performer tonight. Physical presence.
He's one of the guys that really answered the bell for Dallas. Dallas felt like they didn't come out in game one and play a very aggressive game. Well, Morrow has certainly done that. This is a guy that can do a lot of different things. He can fill in on your top two lines. He can play in a checking role if he has to. He scored 3 shorthanded goals this year, 21 goals. He's a tough kid. And really is one of those versatile guys that Dallas likes to have. They can move him around line to line.
Ethan Morrow has it now. Back to the line. Stamos the shot. Right pass saved by Turco. Nevsky with it. Tried to go rink wide. Intercepted. And DeMaio finds Ulf Dahlin coming out of the box. Play is onside. Dahlin, his shot. And Markkanen held his ground and made the save. And the puck over the glass hand out of play. The Stars on their way to evening up this series.
For more information, visit DallasStars.com.
The X Games Global Championship, coming in May on ESPN.
Ladies, are y'all getting in this cool outstretch? It's a dance.
You can put a big screen TV in there.
Where your man at? Hey, you know you need a player in there to help with them 200 horses. Gotta get your groove on. Hey, can I get some love?
Hey, I like that. Dot strutting, strutting.
Oh, wait.
Grab Dodge's 770 powertrain limited warranty. Ford, Chevy, and Toyota don't match it.
There's only two ugly people in the world, and your mama's both of them.
You know, your mama's so fat, she stepped on a dollar and made change.
I heard your mama's so ugly, she robbed a bank with no gun, just stuck her head over the counter and said, put that money in the bag.
Stick them up. Stick them up.
Timing was a little off.
Oh, timing was a little off.
Timing was way off.
You're not funny.
Tell it over a great tasting, less filling Miller Lite. It's Miller time.
Up top.
Hey, honey, I got on that earlier flight out of Boston. Can you still pick me up?
Sure, I'll be there.
Great, I'll see you in LA.
Life's good when you're Kristen Davis. But life's better when you're Kristen Davis and you have the cell phone with a walkie-talkie.
Hello?
Coast-to-coast walkie-talkie service coming soon, only from Nextel.
Ethan Moreau is in the penalty box. The Edmonton Oilers have taken another one. And a four-minute minor.
That'll pretty well leave him shorthanded for the rest of the night unless Dallas bangs in a couple of power play goals. Scotty Young back on the point here for Dallas. Remember, he's got the two goals.
Short-handed, here comes Reisner. Takes a look across, hangs down to the puck, then bans on it as he tried to send it toward the net. 13 power play opportunities for the Dallas Stars. David Oliver lost the stick. George Larocque out there in a penalty-killing situation. He's also out there to flash his badge if need be.
Yeah, Big George doesn't get too much penalty killing time here, so keep an eye on Big 27 for Edmonton.
Well, Craig McTavish said there's always pressure on a team that loses the first game at home, but he said, I don't expect it to be too much of a pressure-packed situation for a veteran team like the Dallas Stars, and they certainly have played like the dominant team tonight. Here's a one-timer on the way. Markkanen, I don't think ever saw that, and it sailed just wide on the glove side. Now it comes to Young again. He drives a shot that was deflected off the stick of Horkoff as he got it in the way of the shot. Back to the line. Here is Young again. Backhands it across Zubov. Young at the top of the circle. Just over 2 minutes left to this one. DeMaio with it. Sends it back out to the line. Young to Rob DeMaio. Down low it goes down to Zubov. Back to DeMaio. DeMaio takes a look, patient with it, patient, sends it across. Here is Young. Back to Zubov. Very patient, the Dallas Stars on this power play. They're in no rush. The shot does not get through. Back to the line. Here is Young with him. He tees it up. And Markkanen held his ground and made the save.
Scotty Young's going to have sore arms here if they keep giving it to him.
Zubov misses the net. It's back out to Young at the point. Larocque takes a run at him, takes him down. Larocque's going to go for another penalty. He might try to get another hit in here on Young.
Don Van Massenhoven blew the whistle even though Dallas had the puck because it was clear to him. I've really not seen this before. It was clear to him that Larocque was going to take a run at Scott Young.
Yeah.
I've not seen that before.
Well, Larocque really heard it from the Dallas bench. And boy, does this set up something interesting for games 3 and 4 up in Edmonton.
Here you see Larocque come back into the zone. He gives him the stick and the slew foot, which is an absolutely cheap play. Guys get hurt doing that. The puck goes over to the boards, and Larocque was chasing him down. Van Massenhoven blew the whistle. And Larocque will go in the box, and this will finish up as a two-man advantage. They pull Larrack away, and now the guys are giving it to Larrack. Probably they're asking him what he's doing out there, penalty killing. I know that's something that gets said quite often when a guy that doesn't kill very, very much is out there. But Larrack wasn't happy with what he heard, and here goes Dallas on yet another 5-on-3. They're getting a lot of practice on this tonight.
You know, the Edmonton Oilers, 21 times in their history, have won game one of a series. They have won 20 of those series. That's on the line as this thing will be even up, going back for game three to Edmonton. Save made by Markkanen. Less than a minute left in this one. Back to Boucher. He sends it across. Now it comes to Oliver to the front of the net. Save. Rebound. Malhotra. He sends it wide.
Nice save by Markkanen. Here's the tough spot for the young guy. He gives up his first NHL career goal in a playoff game on his first shot, but he's done well the last 10 minutes. The puck's been in his end the whole 10 minutes.
Great. Is what happened here tonight, and obviously with Dallas winning, they have the benefit of the momentum, but with everything else that's gone on with announcements, does it have any impact on how game three will start in Edmonton?
Well, if there was any question whether it was going to be an intense start in Edmonton, this pretty well takes it away. And the building in Edmonton is very loud, and I think you can expect a very physical start by the Edmonton Oilers. The key is going to be if Dallas can match it early on.
Final 5 seconds of this one. The crowd that's still here at American Airlines Center comes to their feet.
Dominating performance, start to finish by the Dallas Stars. They wanted to come out aggressively. They said they weren't ready to play an intense game in game one. Well, they certainly did here in game two. Edmonton shot themselves in the foot all night long, put themselves in penalty trouble right from the beginning of the first period. Big night for Scott Young, a couple of goals. Looked very good tonight, the Dallas Stars did.
Sets up an interesting return to Edmonton for games three and four next week. 6-1, our final here. Don't forget our next game's a doubleheader tomorrow on ESPN2, 7 Eastern. Islanders and Senators, game two of that series. That'll be followed at 10 by the Blues and Canucks. The Blues lead that series 1-0. Coming up next is NHL Tonight. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. For more, log on to ESPN.com. From my rookie partner, Ray Ferraro, the rest of our crew down on the truck, I'm Dave Streeter. Thanks for joining us. The Stars win it 6-1. Let's go to John Barry and EJ, NHL Tonight.
Let's get ready to rumble! WWH, as in hockey, the Flyers and Leafs go Rudy Pooh style in game number two. Stoned by Marty Brodeur in game one, Glenn Murray gives the Bruins a backhanded compliment and a rough game two in Jersey. The champs dominate, but get dominated by Jiggy. We break down the Red Wings, Ducks, and Canucks Blues.
You know, we just didn't even deserve to be in the same league, let alone the same rink.
And the Edmonton Oilers can taste a 2-0 series lead in Dallas. NHL Tonight, now! Night three of the Stanley Cup playoffs in the books. Alongside
best night too.
EJ the Magazine, EJ Raddick, and Barry Melrose. I'm John Butchikosh. You're right. Three sold-out
awesome,
barns.
Awesome.
Well, it's Friday night. People are lathered up.
Hockey fans go out every night, not just Friday.
The work week is over. Time to let it loose, and that they did. Flyer goalie Roman Čechmánek said that many Flyer players were nervous before Game 1 against Toronto. Jeremy Roenick admits he was one of them. Quote, "I am very anxious for the series," Roenick said. "I really want to win this real, real bad. Monday and Tuesday, I was a nervous wreck in anticipation of the series starting and waiting all year for it," end quote. A jittery Flyer gang lost game one despite outshooting Toronto 31-15. Game two, and oh, Barry, I love the pregame jocularity.
All right, here you see Brashear, you see Domi. Unbelievable, the excitement in the building. Everyone's watching the pregame skate. Domi sending a couple messages. Brashear lets him know he's going to be available.
And early on, some discipline issues for Toronto. So can the Flyers take advantage on the power play? Not here. Leafs kill the penalty. Then another penalty.
One.
Sundin cross-checks Primo. So the Flyers, another chance. Don't forget, they're 3-12 in their last 15 playoff games entering this one. Flyers 0-2 on the power play. Then they go shorthanded. Williams cross-check on Roberts. And wouldn't you know it, Barry, an ensuing Leaf power play. Here comes Simone Gagné. He will follow up, and they get 1-0. E.J. Redick, can this guy stay healthy for the playoffs?
Well, they better hope so. I mean, he's a great element when he's there. A lot of speed. Eddie kicks out a little bit of a rebound there, but Gagné drives hard to the net, gets the goal.
He's been battling, of course, that groin injury. He played 12 minutes, 57 seconds. Later, Gagné, again, that speed around McCabe. McCabe and Housley had an awful game. Flyers outshoot Toronto 15-5 in the first. Lead 2-0. Roenick the goal. Alex the Great has been great. Fourth goal in two games. Leafs down 2-1. Čechmánek, don't forget, 3-8 all time in the playoffs.
Plays it very poorly. The goalie's supposed to come across without turning his back on the play. Čechmánek turned a complete circle.
Driver 8, take a break. That might have been Johnny Vermont's goal, but Recky will get it. Makes it 3-1, EJ.
Well, I mean, this is where the game was played all night to me. Every time I looked, I saw a crowd in front of Belfour. When you got people there, bad things happen to your team.
That's probably Recky's goal. Later in the second, Flyer power play, LeClaire. This one's Johnny. Didn't see it go in, but it's good. Philly outshoots Toronto 16-5 in the second, up 4-1. Barry, let's get rid of the goals and stuff.
Yeah. Let's get to see what all the people in Philadelphia wanted to see. And now Brashear and Domi, they were yelling at Domi all night long from the warm-up on. This guy is a warrior. He's very much smaller than Brashear, but he went toe-to-toe. And I give the bout, split decision, but I give it to Domi.
What Chris Martin is to Coldplay.
He's not done yet. You went down. You went down.
What Chris Martin is to Coldplay, Ken Hitchcock is to the Flyers. His championship defensive coaching has the Flyers out shooting Toronto 67-32 in the series. John LeClair snaps a 10-game playoff goal drought. Simone Gagné snaps an 8-game playoff drought. Mark Recchi, a 7-game postseason goalless streak. Johnny Vermont, you have tied the series at 1.
We wanted to be a little hungry around the net. That was one of our keys tonight. Try to find those pucks in front of the net and bang them home.
We were hungry on the puck. We were relentless on the puck tonight, and we created a lot of turnovers. So we were workhorses today. That was just a difference.
Tonight we had every guy on board, and like I said, we're going to have the same effort from every guy every night the rest of the way in order to win.
We're outplayed in the first game, I thought, and then tonight again, and we should be feel very lucky to go home with the split, and now we have to play better at home.
Barry, you harp on physical battles. It's two words you say a lot here. And McCabe and Housley were a -3. Break down some of the physical battles in this game. Who won them?
Well, Philly is a huge team. And if you're not ready to go to war against Philadelphia Flyers, you're going to have a tough night. And Toronto was not ready to go to war against Philadelphia Flyers. Housley's game is all about offense and moving the puck and being a great skater. When he has to win physical battles, that's a tough job for the veteran. Right here, it's him on Gagné. Gagné has a puck. There's no problem. Now, Housley's job is to take Gagné. You do not let the man go by you there and get the rebound. Mistake Housley. He's got to do a better job. Now let's look in front of the Toronto net in the next goal. Right here you see Healy. He's right there with his man. Everything's there. He goes and changes on Johnny LeClaire, which is a good change, but he's not strong on his stick, and LeClaire wins the physical battle and gets a goal. A little bit later, McCabe, the most physical of all Toronto defensemen, gets ate up by Johnny LeClaire. Those goals cannot happen, and EJ was right. The game took place in front of Eddie Belfour, and Philadelphia won all the battles in front of Eddie Belfour. So I think that's one of the things that has to change for Game 3 and Game 4.
Game 3 is Monday night in Toronto on ESPN. While the Blackhawks' Theo Fleury has been determined by the National Hockey League to be in stage 3 of its substance abuse policy, meaning that as of Friday, he is suspended for 6 months. After 6 months, Fleury can apply for reinstatement, but it is up to the league in consultation with its doctors as to whether he is reinstated or not. He'll be 35 in June, just 36 goals in his last 136 games. EJ, what's his future? First of all, in Chicago, he has one more year left on his contract.
Well, it looks like Johnny's going to be bought out at some point there. I mean, everybody's talked about the fact that, you know, Chicago would like to get out from under that $4 million next year. So that could be a big nightmare there. But, you know, let's face it, the guy's skills are kind of waning now. You know, $4 million is a lot to play somebody. I think it was probably a bad idea to sign up for that much money in the first place. They didn't do their due diligence and find out, you know, where this guy was. And he had some problems, you know, obviously during the beginning of the season. He had more problems again later in the season. You know, who knows what's going to happen to Theo Fleury right now? I mean, do you see this guy getting another chance, Barry?
Look, I love Theo Fleury, and I know what he's been through, and I know his background. I've known him since he's been 14 years old. But the bottom line is it's time for Theo Fleury to take care of this problem. And what we hope and what we care about and what we think doesn't matter. Until Theo decides that enough is enough, I've hit rock bottom, and we've heard this rock bottom from Theo 3 or 4 times before. Yeah. I've hit rock bottom, I'm going to change. I've hit rock bottom, I'm going to change. Until he finally does it, I think it's up to him to change. I think the NHL has bent over backwards. I think the Chicago Blackhawks have bent over backwards. It's time for him to change. But
I think if he does change, another team will give him one more chance.
Well, Bill Wirtz always complaining about money. What about giving $9 million to Theo Fleury? See if he complains about that. Game two, Bruins and Devils. That's coming up also. Another game to go, including the only favorite seed wise to win their game one, New Jersey.
Turnover in front court was tied up. Backhander in front, score! Murray on the backhander!
Daryl Sedor, a terrific play to Scott Young. This is a pass all the way. Young's able to tip it past Tommy Salo.
Let's say this is you, and this is your auto insurance company. You've always gotten along okay, but let's say this is Allstate. Ooh, looks better than what you got now, huh? Well, qualified drivers who call Allstate for a free auto quote can get a company this good for this kind of price, maybe less. The choice is pretty simple, don't you think? So call Allstate now for an auto quote and find out how you're in good hands with Allstate.
Hello?
Hey, how you doing? You want to grab some dinner?
Oh, it's you. You don't call for ages, and I'm just supposed to say, hi, great, dinner, fine.
No, yeah, but
I... nothing. Did you hibernate or something?
Whoa.
Hey, go around.
Shh. Yeah.
Look up, see blue, look back blue.
You must be so hungry.
Oh, yeah.
Hey, you're gonna love this new quick rent at National Car Rental.
When you get to the airport, they let you choose your own car.
Whatever make and model you want.
Whatever color you want.
You can walk right past the counter.
And you don't stand in any lines.
All you need is a major credit card and access to the internet. You rent online at nationalcar.com.
They ought to call it quick and easy.
Bypass the counter.
You don't have to stand in line.
Choose your own car.
Click, click, click on the computer.
It's all about me. Rent, huh?
Choose the rental car company that lets you choose your own car. Quick rent at nationalcar.com.
Baseball Tonight, all season long on ESPN and ESPN2.
Access the Stanley Cup Playoffs. Islanders versus Senators and Blues versus Canucks. Will you be watching?
NHL Tonight, brought to you by Allstate. Come find out how the right hands can make all the difference for you.
Game two, Bruins, Devils, Martin Brodeur, and the Devils trying to go up two games to love. He has 68-48 all-time in his playoff history. First period, Joe Thornton backhanded pass, Glenn Murray backhanded goal. Brodeur got the best of Murray in game one. Murray gets the best of Brodeur right there. He had five shots on goal, 1-0 Bees. Later first, triangle offense here. Nieuwendyk, Langen, Brunner, Friesen, 1-1, Barry.
Best line in the playoffs of any team in the NHL. Nieuwendyk cycles the puck down low here, which is a great move. Langenbrenner, who's on fire, gets a puck. Now, Friesen's job is to get into a hole. He can't stand with a man between him and the pass. Two steps to the left, one-time shot, great goal.
John Madden, boom, right there. Ryan Rafalski played 25 minutes and 21 seconds to lead New Jersey, and he gives them a 2-1 lead. Then, let me hear your body talk. Ralston goes to the net, shoved by Brodeur, Axelsson and Whiteberry. Boy, this is your kind of night.
Well, LaPointe went down badly on his knee. I hope he's not hurt. But right here, PJ is a pest. He's not a real tough guy. He's not like Domi and Brashear, but he's got guts, and he stood toe-to-toe with White there.
Looks like Daniel Alfredson. Dan McGillis ties the game at two. Now, a power play for the Devils. It's been a problem for them. Jamie Langenbrunner, one time from Niedermeyer, EJ, on a sellout crowd in Jersey. That's rare.
That is rare, I'll tell you. And it's almost as rare as a power play goal for the Devils, and they got two of them tonight. That's why you win games for a power play goal.
Weird, wacky stuff. Look at that save by Brodeur. First on Samsonov, then on McInnes.
Puck is laying there. Watch, it hits actually a New Jersey defenseman's foot.
Rafalski
leaves the crease.
What a game for Rafalski. Later, look at that pass from Langenbrunner. Nieuwendyk! That is some talent.
What a pass by Langenbrunner. Exactly right. A saucy pass right on the tape.
Neuendijk wins 56% of his faceoffs. Devils lead the series 2-0. They held the Bruins to 5 shots on goal in the third. Devils have never lost a series when they've led 2-0. 5 points in the series for Langenbrunner. Ken Danico has played in every New Jersey Devil game in the playoffs ever played. 164 straight. Game 3, Sunday afternoon on ESPN. Martin Brodeur and the Devils, 2 wins away from eliminating the Bruins.
Going into Boston, we can expect probably even a lot more physical play. So it was going to be interesting to see how we respond on the road. We've been good all year on the road, but last time we played over there, we didn't do so well. So, you know, we're looking forward to the challenge.
They have some tough guys over there, and they're going to play hard, you know that. And so you got to, you know, match them hit for hit and play for play. And so far, we've been able to do that.
Bruins have lost all 24 times. They have trailed a best-of-seven series, 2-0. Imagine that.
That's a lot. You'd have thought they'd come back at least once. They had some great teams, too, in those
Sabres
years.
Sabres are the only other club with double-digit series losses and no victories under these circumstances. On the flip side, the Devils, again, have closed out all 6 series after having a 2-0 advantage. Bill Guerin said he is not sure if he will travel with the team to Edmonton for games 3 and 4 of the Stars' first-round playoff series, which leads to speculation that Guerin will not play in at least the first round. I am making progress, Guerin says. It's just day by day. Game 2 of the Stars-Oilers best-of-7 series with the Oilers up 1-0 21 times in the past 29 playoff games between the Stars and Oilers. The game has been decided by 1 goal, including 8 of the past 9. Would that be one of those games? There's Marty Turco. It would not be a busy night for him at all. First period, Kirk Muller, a little bump into the goalie. He gets a penalty. He doesn't like it. That's twice! Ensuing Oiler power play.
Unless he wants 2 of something.
Maybe Marty Riesner banks it off the right pad of Marty Turco.
Didn't start great for Marty Turco. He came across, he didn't get over to the post, protected. Soft goal, we'll see how he responds.
Stars on the power play. Ethan Moreau bumps into Turco. That's a penalty. Craig McTavish, you're not happy. What about Ray Ferraro's thoughts?
See, I don't like this penalty. The goaltender's 40 feet out of the net. Moreau has to go somewhere. He's reaching for the puck.
That is not a good call.
Goaltenders are too protected.
So 5-on-3 power play for Dallas. Sergei Zubov, twisted wrist. First of the playoffs, 1-1, and now Craig Mack's really not happy about it, Barry.
Well, he's got some reason to be, but also his team did a lot of stupid things tonight. They weren't very disciplined. Right here you see Comrie definitely got a hold on the Dallas player. Should be called. A little bit later, definite hook on Robbie DeMille. Should be called. Right here.
Ouch.
That is unbelievable. That's right in the slot, right in front of the referees. Edmonton was not a smart club tonight at all.
Well, that guy's a smart player. Scott Young, EJ Raddick.
Versatile guy, can score goals for you. And with Guerin out, you know, you needed Young to come up and come up with some big goals. He got 2 tonight, the redirect, and then that blistering one-timer there. Good night for Scott Young.
That's a good point. Third period, more Stars. Brendan Mora was sensational all night long. Michael Modano, that rang off the right post. 5-1 Dallas. Then things get ugly. Corey Cross, little punch. They call that a cross check, but it wasn't a cross check. It was a left foot jab. And then here we go, Barry.
Well, old-time hockey here. The game's out of hand. Edmonton sending a message. They're letting the Dallas Stars know that they're going to be ready for Game 3. Dallas Stars is letting Edmonton know that they'll be there for the Edmonton Oilers in Game 3.
All right, Marty Turco, 12 saves. He only saw 13 shots in this one. This is the first time Edmonton has allowed at least 6 goals in a playoff game since May 6, 1992. Edmonton had 13 shots on goal. Scott Young had 8, including 2 goals and 1 interview with Dave Strader and Ray Ferraro.
Dallas Stars with a dominating win in Game 2 to even up this series, joined by Scott Young, who had a couple of goals. And let's go back to the beginning of this game, because there was some talk by some of your guys, including your captain, Darian Hatcher, Scott, who felt there wasn't enough intensity in Game 1. You guys certainly came out with a different outlook here in Game 2.
Yeah, we didn't play near as intense as we wanted to in that first game, especially here at home, and it's the start of the playoffs, so it was a disappointing start. But we came out in the first period. We were ready. We were really focused tonight, and very determined that we had to win this game, because it would have been really tough if we went down 2-0.
Scotty, as a veteran, you know, you're one of the guys that has to step up. You scored 2 goals in the first period, one of them off a terrific pass from Daryl Sador, the other off a great play from Brendan Morrow. Can you walk us through your goals a little bit?
Yeah, the first one, you know, I stayed in the slot there a little bit and just tried to stay patient. And, you know, Sid made a great, you know, shot pass to me, and I just redirected it and went, I think it went between his legs. And the next play, I just got the puck off quick. You know, Brendan Morrow gave me a nice pass, and just tried to get it off as quick as possible.
Scott, as things started to deteriorate, you know, we're talking about how we're trying to fill in up here in the booth and what to talk about, but you're trying to focus on continuing to play, and there you are out there on the power play looking for the hat trick, and you got George Laroque out there as a penalty killer. That's got to be a little bit difficult to focus.
Yeah, I was fully aware that George Laroque was on the ice. You know, it wasn't so much that I was even looking for the hat trick. It was that we didn't have any defensemen left, so I had to go out there. And we had one D left on the bench, so they wanted me to kill some time on the power play, play the point, and just kind of until we got some D back. So, I was definitely aware George was there. I knew he was going to take a run at me when that puck came around the boards.
Scotty, Marty Turco, a lot was made. He struggled in game one. He didn't have a lot to do in game two here tonight, but he made some good saves. You talk about how confident he is in the room. I've seen him on the ice and, you know, playing against him. Just I'm amazed that nothing seems to bother him.
Yeah, his attitude's great. And, you know, as players, we have absolutely no worries about him. I don't know. There's some talk about game one, and I don't know why. You know, we gave up two goals, just didn't play very well. And, you know, no worries about Marty at all. I know it's his first playoffs, but his demeanor and his, you know, mentality off the ice, he's pretty laid back. He's not going to let the pressure get to him. And he's a very focused guy, and he's aggressive on the ice, and he helps us out so much the way he plays the puck. Even if he's not making... you know, big saves because he doesn't have to. He's playing the puck and helping our breakout.
Well, Scott, we appreciate you stopping by. Congratulations on the two goal and the victory here tonight.
Thanks, guys.
Dallas Stars with a big win. They even the series against the Edmonton Oilers at a game apiece. Let's send it back to the studio.
I'm fully aware George Laroque's on the planet. Always ready for him. Quote, we needed to win that game, defenseman Keith Carney said. The way Jigger played, we had to win that game for him. Anaheim's Game 1 triple overtime win over the Red Wings is the game of the playoffs so far, as J.S. Jigger made 63 saves. Jigger had to be hooked up to an IV after the game. Brendan Shanahan scored on the Wings' fourth shot on a power play, 4:15 in. Jiggy then made 60 straight saves. The Wings lose home ice and their first playoff game ever to Anaheim, but it is just one game.
Well, it was an interesting game in that... I mean, the period after period after period, and all of a sudden there'd be a flurry of shots or saves or a breakaway, and as it turned out, it was a traditional goal that won the hockey game, a face-off, a point shot, find a rebound, and a goal. So, you know, that happens.
That's sports. That's what makes sports great, and their goalie played a great game, and it's just one of those things. I think for us, we just got to go back and... you know, we just got to regroup and keep going at the net. Keep putting the puck at the net. It's going to go in sooner or later.
So Jiggy sets the tone with 63 saves, NHL expansion era record for a goalie making his first playoff start. The Wings, don't forget, the oldest club in the league with an average age of 31 years, 185 days. And game two is an afternoon game on Saturday. And Fedorov and Hall were a bit quiet in the latter portions of the series opener. Red Wings outshot Anaheim 36-13 after regulation. Paul Kariya's game-winning goal scored after Steve Ruchin wins the faceoff.
Well, I think a couple things happened. Number one, in the old days, a goaltender, they always took fluids after a game two, but they weren't IVs. And number two, let's not analyze this series to death. The bottom line is Jaguar was unbelievable. He won the game for the Mighty Ducks. There's no doubt about it. This game could have been out very early in the first period. He was fantastic, but he has been all year. This is not a surprise. This guy's numbers are as good as any goalie in the NHL. He plays as much as anybody in the NHL. Obviously a great goaltender and got the job done. One of the differences the Ducks is they can score more, and Steve Ruchin's healthy. You see right there, he wins a draw on the goal that won the game by Paul Kariya. But he plays against Fedorov every shift. He played against him all game long. That is one of the reasons Fedorov isn't getting as much open ice he usually gets. Steve Ruchin, very underrated player on the Ducks, but let's give the credit where the credit is due, and that's the goaltender, Jaguar.
Mm-hmm. Game two, ABC, Saturday. We come back. Are the Vancouver Canucks still choking? We preview game two against the St. Louis Blues. But first, tonight's question. Who is the only active goaltender to post a shutout in his first career playoff start? Jiggy didn't quite get it, but he certainly spawned this question. Oh boy, the boys are pondering intently.
Hey, Smith, you get a raise?
No, I got an Optima.
Introducing the Kia Optima midsize sedan.
Smith got a raise and options.
With available V6.
VP?
10-year, 100,000-mile warranty.
Smith's taking over.
Smith. And a starting price around
$16,000. Watch your back, Smith.
Smith Worldwide.
It'll just look like you got a raise.
the Kia Optima. Right now, get 0% financing or up to $3,000 cash back.
Drinks before lunch?
Water's fine for me.
Water for me too, but with lemon, please.
I'll have a Sam Adams, please.
None.
Make that 2 Sam Adams.
Samuel Adams, always a good decision.
In the old days, athlete's foot meant using Lotrimin AF or Tenactin for 4 whole weeks.
Who does that? Today, Lamisil AT kills the fungus with just 1 week's use.
And keeps you athlete's foot free for 3 months.
Lamisil AT. There's no better way to cure athlete's foot.
Did you miss any of this year's NCAA games? Well, ESPN Classics got not one, not two, but 3 of the best from this year's tournament. And they're all instant classics, like Drew Nicholas's buzzer-beating 3 to win it for the Terps. Arizona hangs on against Gonzaga. Plus, this year's NCAA final between Syracuse and Kansas. It all adds up to a triple instant classic. Starts 5 p.m. Sunday, only on ESPN Classic. Get ESPN Classic. Call your cable or satellite provider now.
So close, within a hair, but not quite there. The hair stays for April Savings Day. Right now, get savings up to 10 grand or financing as low as 0 APR on Toyota, Honda, Jeep, Lincoln, Mercury, Subaru, Mitsubishi, Hyundai, and more. If you're in the market for a new car, the Bob Romanato Group is here for you.
There's only one, Bob Roman.
The Bob Romanato Group, Sagamore Parkway, Teal Road, Creasy Lane, Lafayette.
Oh, you're lucky, young fella.
Mm-hmm.
You know, hospitals didn't even use ether for your procedure until about 1846. Yeah, slap on a few live leeches, grab a hacksaw, get to work. Of course, we don't use leeches anymore.
It's fun to know history. Find curious facts from America's past at loc.gov, the Library of Congress website.
Access the Stanley Cup Playoffs.
What a stop!
Islanders versus Senators and Blues versus Canucks. Will you be watching?
NHL tonight after Blues and Canucks. All right, boys, the question, what do you think?
I think it's Colzy.
I'm going to say Cujo.
The guy just can't get any respect, whether it's on the ice.
We know who it is.
Whether it's tonight's question.
Know who it is.
Osgood.
Chris Osgood. What does the guy got it? Lucas Dimitra, 6 pounds, 19 inches, was born at 8:40 p.m. on Wednesday. His dad, Pavel Dimitra, flew 3,500 miles to Vancouver, back to St. Louis to see Pav Henry Jr. enter the world.
Bet you his arms were sore.
And then back to Vancouver, arriving 2 hours before the start of Game 1, which the Blues won 6-0 over Vancouver. Alexander Havanov said, and Barry, you'll like this quote, "It's a great thing for the organization to fly Dimitra home. In Russia, you would learn your kid was born on the rink radio." What a country. Meanwhile, the Vancouver Canucks feel like they're 19 inches tall after getting spanked 6-0.
We got outplayed in absolutely every aspect of the game tonight, and you know, to coin a cliche, you know, we've lost a game certainly, but you know, there's 3 other teams on our side that are in the same predicament as us, although I don't think any of them got drubbed like we did.
Well, we have to forget about this one. It was a tough one, and looking ahead now, I think it'll be a huge difference. If we just get a win here, I think everything's going to change.
Vancouver had 4 shots on goal in the first, 6 in the second. Their power play 0 for 7. St. Louis is 3 of 9.
Well, I really believe, and this is how Mark Crawford should handle it, is it's a lot easier coming back when you've got killed and you were terrible and you got beat in every aspect of the game than saying Vancouver played their best game of the year and they still got beat 2-1. Then what do you do as a coach? He can go in there, he can say, guys, we were terrible, we didn't work hard enough, we just got to come, throw that game out, we're not even going to look at the tape, and just start battling. A couple things that must change, though, is the discipline of the Vancouver Canucks. They took too many bad penalties. Bertuzzi took a bad penalty. Where does the puck end up? Stillman scores a power play goal. Right after that, Eddie Joe comes in, takes a bad penalty in front of the net. That also ends up in their net. Tkachuk ends up scoring a power play goal, so they're down 2-0. 2 bad penalties, 2 power play goals. St. Louis got an excellent power play, too many offensive weapons. And what made it even worse is Pronger's back in the penalty kill along with McGinnis. Barrett Jackman is a physical force back there. So not only did they score power play goals, they also killed penalties excellently. So I think those are great things that the St. Louis Blues are building on. From the choke comment, I think that can be fixed if you play better. But what do you think, EJ?
I don't know. I mean, I heard that choke comment on Sunday, and you know, they didn't You know, they lost some thing. They lost the division title, but the playoffs are what matters. And, you know, just looking at them last night, it looks like everybody's trying too hard. Everybody's trying to carry the load there. I mean, as a coach, Barry, when you see that, I mean, what can you do? It seems like it's almost like something that's rolling downhill on this team now.
Well, they got to put a stop to it. And the way you put a stop to it is, number one, goaltending. And again, we've talked about this before. Kluche's not 100%, and I don't think he's close to being 100%. So is the goaltending good enough to stop a slide like this? And it's got to be leadership. Bertuzzi and Naslund carry this team all year long on their backs, offensively. Whenever they needed a goal, one of those two guys got it. Now it's up to them. If you want to be a great player during the regular season, you got to be a better player during the playoffs.
All right, and again, that penalty killing is an issue against a great St. Louis Blue team. Yep. The third worst since Christmas, since Matthias Olin has been out. Mm-hmm. They hope he's back for game two.
They need him back.
He's their second-best defenseman after Joe Vanowski. Okay, speaking of the Blues, Peter Senia is the Hobey Baker Award winner. First European to win the award. The Blues signed him. He played the last game of the regular season and scored a goal in Colorado. So Senia of Colorado College is the winner of the Hobey Baker Award. The Sharks have granted Teemu Selanne an extra 8 days to decide if he will return to the Sharks next season. He holds a $6.5 million option for next season, and his deal stated he had to make a decision within 7 days of the end of the season. But Friday, the team agreed to extend that. Meanwhile, house cleaning in Calgary as GM Craig Button is released and former player and current team executive Lenny McDonald also leaves the team. Head coach Daryl Sutter will assume the duties of GM for the club. And EJ, you first reported this on ESPN.com. The bottom line, ESPN News.
I get around.
Take us through this and what's your general feeling about what happened in Calgary?
Well, I think, John, really what happened was you had a guy in Ken King who was the president of the team there. Craig Button wasn't his guy. He didn't hire him. He wanted to get rid of him, so he got rid of him. He's got Daryl Sutter there, who's a popular figure in that area. Saves some money also because you get rid of one salary. Now Daryl will get both jobs, probably won't get much more money for doing it. And really, I just think it's a quick case where Ken King wanted Craig Button out of the way. Last time I'd looked at the Stanley Cup, though, I saw Craig Button's name on it. I haven't found Ken King's name on it yet. I'm still looking.
What about being a GM and a coach? Of course, Pat Quinn's the only guy who's officially that, but we've seen someone like Doug McClain in Columbus who fired his coach and did both. You did both in the American League?
Yeah, and it's tough in the American League. And Pat Quinn has Bill Waters, a guy that has been a GM, and he does most of the contracts. And, and as a GM, the contracts are everything. That takes 90% of your time. Basically, a GM isn't even a hockey position anymore. It's a business decision. That's one of the problems with hockey today. Most teams are going to a business guy strictly doing contracts and a GM becoming more of a hockey guy. Really, in today's game, a coach doesn't have enough time to coach the team with all that's going on. Handling the press, the video work that's curtailed, the travel arrangements that must be made to get your team to the games and back, and resting when you should and where you should, the practice facility, things like that. I really don't think anybody can do either job justice. And right now, being on the ice and making the playoffs is much more important for the Calgary Flames than anything else. That is what has to happen, getting that team on the ice straightened out.
And of course, the GM job is so important. I mean, this is the guy that has the vision for the franchise. If he's seen
lack of vision.
Right. We see teams like Chicago and Boston who have had very little vision. Look where their teams are now, relatively. Other jobs out there as teams look for this very important position of GM.
Well, the San Jose Sharks, John, are still interviewing people. We've seen a lot of, you know, different names pop up. We've seen Neil Smith's name pop up, the former Ranger general manager. Dave Noonan is an assistant to Brian Burke in Vancouver. He's a name that's come up. John Ferguson Jr., he helps with the Worcester Club, the Blues Farm Club down there, assistant GM. His name has come up. So there's been a bunch of names that have been swirling around. Doug Wilson, another guy right in the organization there. He's a popular figure out there. So they've got to make that decision soon because we're talking about Solana here. You know, wanting to, what are they going to do with Solani? And Solani's got to make a decision. Don't you think he's going to want to know who the general manager of the team is?
Absolutely.
So they've got to make a decision soon there. And,
There's a lot of talk that Darcy Regier is under some problems in Buffalo.
Yeah,
also, he might be gone.
He might be out of the way, too. So I think in Regier's case, though, Bear, it seems like Gary Bettman is kind of going to bat for Darcy Regier a little bit. Like, you know, we ran this club. Darcy was our guy. Just letting you know, he's still under contract to you for a couple more years. You might want to keep him around for a little while.
And I personally believe Darcy Regier has done a great job with what that situation, how they handle it. They've drafted well. They've got one of the youngest teams in the NHL. When you got no money and you're told you got to move your star players, it's a tough thing to do. I think Darcy deserves to stay there.
I don't know. I think the Pekka trade was awful.
That was a money deal. He didn't have the money to keep Pekka.
One thing to remember, Larry Quinn, who's going to be running that team as the president there with the Golisano Group, he hired Darcy Regier to begin with. So right. Darcy's got a little hope to stay with that in mind.
And Doug McClain says he will hire a coach before the draft
in
Columbus.
And in all fairness, what killed the Pekka deal is Conley has not become the player that he should become. That kid right. should be a much better player than he is.
And Piatt's also young, so we'll give that some more time. We come back on Tonight 3. A little bit later, we look at our buddy Chicken Parr making his game analyst debut in Edmonton, Dallas.
I think he'll play very well tonight. He doesn't have to be the best player for the Dallas Stars. He just has to be very solid, as he was all season long.
ESPN HD, sponsored by Philips and Best Buy.
Intense, isn't it?
For in-your-face home theater action, come to Best Buy. From Sony plasma TVs to Bose surround sound, we'll help find the system that's right for you. Get into the action at Best Buy.
I'll take Chris.
Okay. Okay. I'll take Chris's buddy. You playing that?
Why not?
Look up, see blue, Labatt Blue.
Steve-o. Good hands.
Oh, thanks. Instinct.
The Saab 9-3 Sport Sedan just received a 5-star rating for collision safety performance from the European New Car Assessment Program.
Right. I'll see you in Dallas.
Going away on business?
Yeah.
Then stay someplace that has everything you need to succeed in any business. I mean, music, movies, anything.
Whatever business you're in, Courtyard has what you need to be successful.
Are you okay?
I'm good. Jolly good.
Make 5 stays and earn a free weekend. Call 1-888-MARRIOT. Courtyard, your Marriott awaits.
Tonight on SportsCenter, double your pleasure at Augusta. MJ on the brink of playoff elimination. The Stars in need of a win. And the Units looking for his first win. It's SportsCenter after the game on ESPN.
Well, the New York Islanders ended a 91-game drought in the playoffs without a shutout victory on Wednesday with their 3-0 win over Ottawa. That is the fourth longest stretch a team has gone between two shutout triumphs in the postseason. Billy Smith had the other one, the last playoff shutout, 1983 Stanley Cup Finals against the Edmonton Oilers. All right, so game number two. Now, we saw the Dallas Stars come back after a lackluster game one. Philly played fine in game one, but they lost. They come back and win game two. What about Ottawa Saturday night? How will they respond?
Well, we found out about the Flyers tonight, and we found out big time that this is a courageous club with lots of character, and they dominate tonight and physically, mentally, everywhere, and beat the Toronto Maple Leafs. Now, the Ottawa Senators, much has been made about their lack of playoff success, lack of courage, lack of guts, whatever you want to call it. Now, we'll find out what this team is made of in the next game, because if they don't come out and totally dominate a team that they're much better than, much more talented than, and should win in 5 games, if they don't come out and play a great game, then I really think they got problems in that Ottawa dressing room, and I think that team has to really make some changes, maybe in the front office, maybe with personnel.
Game two tomorrow night on ESPN2. Okay, now how will Colorado come out? I mean, they outshoot Minnesota 18-3 in the first period. They came out fine. The crowd was on fire. Talk about the Wild and their defense, E.J. Raddick, and all year what they've done up there. What's their system? How they play?
Well, their system is they do all the little things that a coach tells kids when they're from there to the time they're 3 and 4 and 5 and all the way through repeatedly over and over. This team does all those things. Short shifts. They dump the puck to the right areas. They've got some fast forwards. They get on you. The bottom line, though, really is this. Colorado still could have won this game really easily in the first period. That 18 shots on goal, and Rolison was great in the game. So, you know, the thing for Colorado is stay the course, do the things that we do, And let's get the first goal, don't you think, Barry? Yeah, I mean, you don't want to play from behind against the Wild.
Minnesota's a low-paid New Jersey Devils. That's the bottom line. They play the exact same system. They play exactly the same way. The formula is exactly the same. And it worked to a T. Rolofsson, as EJ said, made some great saves in the first period when the Colorado Avalanche dominated. Could easily have been 3-0. It wasn't. And when Minnesota scores the first goals, we've talked about it before, they have the best win percentage in the NHL. So Colorado has to come out, score the first goal, and just go from there. Make Minnesota play catch-up. But Colorado can't panic. They look at the tape and say, hey, we played a pretty good game. Just go out and do it again. And that's what you got to do. Don't panic. Don't change a thing. If it ain't broke, don't fix it.
Devils players think they're a low-paying Minnesota Wild team.
No, well, Minnie is the lowest-paid team in the NHL, so the Devils can't even cry poor to them.
Okay, game two, Tampa Bay, another team that lost game one at home. How will they come out against the Washington Capitals? Peter Bonder assisted on the first of Robert Lang's two game one goals. Jaromir Jagr extends his goalless stretch to 8 games, including the regular season. Tampa Bay's power play 0-4. And Barry, you know, Tampa Bay has a lot of young players. First time around, the Caps have been there before. Is that what you saw in game one? Was it effort? Was it just focus? What was it for the Lightning?
It was that Kolzig matched Habby Boulin, which doesn't happen very often. Habby Boulin's usually the best goaltender on the ice. Kolzig, I thought, was great at times. He made that save on LeCavalier when it was a 1-0 game. And then Washington went down and made it 2-0, changed the game around. And also, when you make a mistake against Washington, it ends up in Robert Lang's stick. It ends up in Jagr's stick. Jagr did not score a goal, but I thought he was very effective. Nylander is effective offensively. Bondra, we know what he can do. So I think there's just too many offensive weapons and too good a goaltending for Washington.
All right. Well, before he was Chicken Parm, his nickname was Seagull, a name given to Ray Ferraro by Islander coaching legend Al Arbor, who said Ray was a seagull because he was either doing one of two things, and one was squawking. Well, Parm squawked for ESPN2 during Game 2 of the Stars-Oilers, and for tonight's three, we take a listen to Ray's greatest hits in his NHL game analyst debut.
Not only are we 5 floors above here, Dave, it's when you're short like me, it's a long way from the rink. I can barely see over the edge. Dallas will try and hold the puck. There's Ulf Dahlin again. He does it so well behind the net.
Ulf Dahlin controlling it well, as Ray mentioned. Center pass, goal! A lot tougher out here. You don't have your own makeup person. Sit there watching all the games and just relaxing. This is more work out here.
I try not to let my buddies know that I'm now a complete makeup wearer, so if just keep that under wraps, Strades, that'd be awesome.
Got to keep that shine down. Now, you had one problem with Ray, and what was that?
You hold the mic too daintily, Ray. Hold it right here like a man. You know, be strong on that mic. Let him know you want to talk.
Hold it like a 1950s goaltender holds his post-game IV. All right. Night three was an awesome night of the Stanley Cup playoffs. Of course, back all day Saturday. You're on ABC in the afternoon. And then ESPN2 here at night, followed by NHL Tonight after Vancouver, St. Louis. Peace.
NHL Tonight is a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. For more, log on to ESPN.com.
Season. Joe Thornton, third leading scorer in the NHL, had yet to get a goal so far in this series, but that ended very quickly here, Ray.
Right at the tail end of the first period on the power play, he takes a third rebound and puts it by Marty Brodeur. Later on, Jonathan Gerrard hits Brodeur high in the shoulder. Dan McGillis comes in and puts it through the five hole. This is a key turning point. Later on, Jeff Friesen on the breakaway. Hackett makes the save. Just moments later, Rolston drops it back, and there's the scoring machine, Dan McGillis. It's two goals in the playoffs for him, and both tonight.
Brodeur really struggled.
Yeah, he did. Marty McGinnis ends Brodeur's night here with the fifth goal against Marty. You don't see that very often. Very uncharacteristic for the New Jersey Devils to give up that many goals in one playoff game.
So the Bruins stay alive, and they do it in emphatic fashion. 5-1 the final. Brodeur giving up those five goals. He's given up six once in a playoff game. That was also a game against Boston, an OT loss back in 94. But certainly one of the worst games you're going to see from Martin Brodeur. Lightning and Capitals has just gone final. Great, great game. First period, Tampa Bay up 1-0. Dinah Zubrus gets pulled down from behind. Penalty shot here, Ray.
Yeah, good call by the official. Now, Zubrus goes in. He's going in pretty slow, but he tries to go upstairs on Javi Bulin. He shoots it right over top of the net.
Here's Zubrus atoning, though.
Yeah, this has got to feel really good. He gets the turnover off of Neskash and puts it right through the five hole. This is a great pass to Marty St. Louis, and he beats Kolzig up high. Tampa Bay's never been a great defensive team. They let Brendan Witt come in from the point and tie it up with just under 3 minutes. Jágr got crushed by Pavel Kabina right here. A clean hit, and he's bleeding from the mouth. And this would be a key play later in the game as it went into overtime. Jágr took the first penalty here, two men short, and Vinny LeCavalier with his first career playoff overtime winner.
For those who weren't with us, could you highlight the players that you talked about off the top that would be important for the Lightning?
Yeah, I had the two guys on the left, LeCavalier and St. Louis, along with Prosper and Brad Richards, and LeCavalier and St. Louis had pretty good nights tonight.
Yeah, that's fairly impressive. I guess that's why you're an analyst, huh?
Well, once in a while you get it right, I guess, forever.
That's very impressive. So the Lightning, 4-3, a huge win for them because, again, the difference between being down 3-0 and down 2-1, they're right back in that series. Stars and Oilers, it's 1-0 in favor of Dallas. Sergei Zubov with the goal, 1-0 at the end of one. We're heading out to this game momentarily. What have you seen so far in this one?
Pretty good pace, as you would expect in a Dallas-Edmonton playoff game. Not a lot of shots, but Salo and Turco have been very good. Turco made a nice save on Alex Hemsky right after the goal by Zubov. Dallas needs Turco to have a good game. He's given up one softie in each goal after just a tremendous rookie NHL season.
Yeah, the tremendous regular season, and obviously they need him to step up here. The Stars on top 1-0. We're heading out to this game right after this quick break.
This intermission report, presented by Dodge, the official road team of the NHL. Grab life by the horns. Dodge.
See you, Bill.
Good job, man.
Rusty,
what's your
hurt? Hey, I'm just trying to get home, man. Introducing the Dodge SRT Series. Race inspired, street legal.
Sweet.
Trust me. Old Man Morgan's parties are epic.
Yeah, if we ever find it.
Duck.
What?
It's a duck!
Nice pants, Rick.
The one and only Dockers Stain Defender.
Tonight, all season long on ESPN and ESPN2.
You have trouble sleeping when you're away from home, don't you? And you've tried everything at those hotels, using extra pillows, raiding the minibar, wearing one of those black eye masks. Nothing works. But have you tried saving money? You'd be surprised how restful getting a great price at a nice hotel can feel. For example,
book a hotel now and be entered to win a 7-night Carnival cruise.
So you can sleep soundly and save money doing it. Travelocity. Call or see site for details.
Are you ready to go mobile for less? You'll go far with $200 off our Gateway 400 SP Plus notebook, featuring a fast Intel 2 GHz processor, CDRW DVD combo drive, and even a 6-in-1 memory card reader. Now only $9.99, and shipping's always included. Are you ready? Call, click, and come in today for Ready Tech Go savings. Only from Gateway, featuring a mobile Intel Celeron processor.
Again, Stars and Oilers 1-0 at the first intermission. Thanks to the goal from Sergei Zubov. We'll get you out for the second period of this game in just a moment. Some other news here on the Dodge Intermission Report. The Penguins fired Rick Kehoe today, about two seasons in the Berg. Never made the playoffs. The Penguins now in search of their seventh coach since the 96-97 season. Ray, this is a franchise that has a lot of problems, financial problems. They got arena problems. Is it fair to fire the coach in all this?
Well, I wouldn't say it was fair if this was just a one-year problem, but Kehoe had some problems even before they had to trade Alexei Kovalev and other guys towards the end of this season. He had only 55 wins in two seasons in Pittsburgh. This is a team financially strapped. They're going into next season. They obviously want a clean slate. They'll hire a new coach. They've fired some of their front office personnel, and a lot of these decisions now, Mario Lemieux's taking a more hands-on approach to them.
Okay, lots more thoughts on that story and some other big stories tonight, including Shane Corson. That's a strange story.
Really odd story, particularly at this time of the year. I